There we go.
Awesome.
Oh my God, we're doing a thing. It's a thing, and we are doing it.
All right, you ready to go to space?
I'm going to talk to Ikora.
Oh yeah, you got to talk to Ikora first.
Yeah. So, how about we talk a little bit about what we're doing?
Sure. Yeah. Stream? So, if you're joining us on stream or on YouTube, myself and Bife are going to be talking about some of the newer lore entries and their wider reaching implications about what we understand about what we're doing and how the universe functions. So, I think the three things we primarily discussed was, we learned a lot about the darkness. So we're going to talk about, the Gardener and the Winnower lore. We're probably going to talk about the Vex and we're definitely going to talk about Oryx.
Oh yes.
And, yeah, so those are the things we're looking at. And I actually am super curious and I'd like to talk about everything with Oryx first.
Uh-huh. Okay.
For me. Yeah. So what was, if y'all don't know, inside the cryptographic, thing in the collector's edition, there's like a puzzle. And after you solve that puzzle, it gave us lore bits about, surprisingly about what the Hive were doing. And learning a little bit more about their internal politics and how they're interacting with each other. And I think the most important thing that we learned was that there are Hive that fundamentally believe Oryx lost on purpose to become the weapon that we are using to kill them in order to make all of the Hive strong enough to bring Oryx back.
And so the crazy thing about all of this is it plays kind of into Oryx's hands. So for those of you who've not read Into the Books of Sorrow all the way to the end, the final card I believe is called, it's either Insight or Revelation. I have a feeling it's Revelation because that sounds like what you'd do for the last one. But Oryx basically has this moment where he sits there and he says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to build a path to a gun that my ultimate enemy who's going to defeat me is then going to use, and they're going to build that gun. That gun ends up being the Touch of Malice, which you actually create by collecting all these calcified fragments. So it makes a lot of sense in the lore, right? After you've done collecting those fragments, though, and after everything is all finished up, you have this moment where the gun gets crafted, but you need three ingredients from the King's Fall raid to do it, which you get on your first run through, the last of which is the Ravenous Heart, which is actually a part of Oryx. In this last kind of part of the Grimoire card as well for the calcified fragment where he talks about this, he states that because of this gun, he will go on existing and that he will have proved his final point because his wielder will be stronger than him, or the gun's wielder rather, will be stronger than him. And as a result, will continue to go on proving the sword logic that only the really strong should prevail. So Oryx has basically tried to kind of cheat death by creating the Touch of Malice. But beyond just that, there are Hive out there who look to the past in the Books of Sorrow. So the really big thing for that is that Oryx has previously actually pulled a stunt where he resurrected his two sisters, Savathun and Shivor Wrath. And the way he does that is by embodying them. And this is where it becomes like really important for the new lore that the Hive have. I think it's in the, I believe it's in the second of the five lore entries that we got after the cryptoglyph puzzle was actually cracked. Which is basically an entry that states that, you know, Savathun got summoned back because Oryx embodied cunning, and Shivor Wrath got summoned back because Oryx embodied war. And the Hive in their millions have a very strong will. And so the Swarm of the Hive, I believe this refers to the Hidden Swarm, but it's only a belief I have because of Inquisition of the Damned, which we can discuss later. The point is they have a really strong collective will in their hundreds of billions. And together, they believe they can use that to bring Oryx back because they can embody the will to resurrect him. And the way that they phrase it with this, it feeds into their kind of completely fanatical belief about it, because at the end of the card, they actually state if, yes, this is heretical because Oryx did not believe in resurrection. He believed that you should not have any kind of power over necromancy or anything like that. It's part of the reason why Nokris is also very controversial. But yeah, he actually, the entry at least, states that the Hive say either he will come back because we've willed him back to life and he will smite us for our sin, or alternatively, our will is stronger than his anyway, And so we'll be continuing to prove the sword logic because we'll have been greater than Oryx's will as a combined whole, which is kind of, it's kind of amazing to sit there and think about it because they're sort of right and sort of not right. You know, they've twisted the logic just a little bit by including themselves as a mass, but I can understand why they're so fanatical about that.
Yeah. So what intrigued me about that lore entry was it was the first time that there was like just really like common disagreement between two Hive factions, something that it was really easy to understand. I'm sure if you look around, there's probably more, but like the two Hive Knights having a disagreement and then throwing themselves off of a bridge was really interesting to me because we have, you know, we've sort of known these divisions of the Hive for a while. And we sort of know their tribute structures and how the people who sit on top work. But the idea of them discovering how their religion operates and the arguments inside of that, you know, how the, like, what's the right way to worship Oryx? You know, like I was on Oryx is super dead. We killed him and we stole his heart and jammed it in a gun. Yeah. But there's a lot of, and this is the scary part to me, there's a lot of solid logic in the Hive that are advocating for the return of Oryx, and that's kind of all the Hive need to make something happen.
Yeah.
Is in order to cast any magic that the Hive had, they just need to capture death or destruction, and then they transform the decay into whatever they want to create.
It's a very roundabout way of saying it works, but effectively, as long as it combines with the sword logic and powerful.
That's an oversimplification, but ultimately, the Hive do have a capacity to do stuff that you wouldn't expect them to be able to do. They surprise us all the time, like capturing void light from guardians and stuff like that. So I like to think that their discussion is indicative of the possibility that these people that want to resurrect Oryx might be successful because the sword logic behind what they're discussing, you know, Oryx using our avarice against us, knowing that he could become the tool with which to make the Hive more perfect, makes a lot of sense, except that it kind of defies his core operating structure.
You see,
and that he's being incredibly cunning to do that, which is not his MO.
Well, I mean, even then, you know, like, Oryx is one of these individuals where I think even that, it doesn't match Savathun's cunning, and I think it's kind of fine. And the reason I say that is because I genuinely don't trust anything where Savathun is involved, because that's the reputation she's garnered. I mean, you know, at the very base, when she was just not as powerful as she is now, she was already at the point where she was betraying her brother so that she could, you know, take over in the War of the Ammonite, and also so that, you know, because of love and war and the way the Hive kind of work, that he could grow stronger and understand the sword logic. They actually talk a whole lot about that, but point being, Savathun is unbelievably cunning, and any time when somebody, like, this is the thing, truth to power for me is a big block when it comes to saying anything of worth. Partly because it talks a lot about Savathun, and whenever someone states anything about Savathun, I'm like, did she write this? And did she intend for us to find this? And is this a trap? You know?
Would you consider, so you like kind of fundamentally consider anything where Savathun is involved or as having like
some kind
extremely unreliable like authorship bias, like the fact that, you know, Savathun may be speaking means that it should be in general ignored?
I don't know if in general ignored. The way that I'd phrase it is,
or untrustworthy.
Untrustworthy is definitely the way I'd look at it, right? You talk about authorship bias, and that's kind of it, but kind of not, you know? Like, Savathun's authorship bias is to lead us down a path that will let us walk into one of her own traps again, you know?
Sure.
She's the one who authors all these machinations, which is why it's not necessarily a bias. It could well just be like, hey, you know, she's just trying to fool us with all of this stuff. And I mean, take a look at what is said in Truth to Power. Like, it's all problematic because of the fact that they start, the book starts off by lying to you. You fall into a hallucination. after having figured out that the person who is lying to you is indeed lying. And then at the very end, the person who has been talking to you this whole time then suddenly states, oh yeah, no, by the way, sorry about all the hallucination stuff. Don't trust all of that. But I am Eris Morn, which was their original lie. And so it's just like, it's all wrapped up in a load of nonsense and it's not trustworthy whatsoever. But the thing that they do give us is a potential insight into Sabathun's court. And the thing that scares me about stuff like that is that, you know, we are not sure if that's entirely how it works. And I feel like those insights are given for a reason. And I feel like those insights are given specifically so we can be misled. So it's, like everybody in the lore community who looked into Truth of Power basically sat there and stated like, hey, Sabathun is not worth trusting. And this is just another good example of why, you know. To bring it all back, though, that just shows like the crazy level of cunning that Sabathun is capable of and often does show throughout all of her time in Destiny. And the I think the real takeaway from all of that is just it doesn't necessarily take away from Oryx's MO for something like this to happen. Because, his thing has always been about like an incredible will and this curiosity to explore the universe, you know, and to go on existing. So, yeah, I can completely understand how it can conflict with his MO, but by that same token, it's kind of not just because Sabathun is just that crazy.
Sure. No, and that was like, that was, I guess for me, it was like the only slight hang up because I'm totally on board. I found that to be interesting.
On that note, Hidden Swarm. And you talked about how there was this division within the Hive. That's something that's really worth touching on because it's really important to the Oryx story. And also, it's worth noting, have you had any time to sort of peek into the Inquisition of the Damned lore book?
I have not.
Okay, so
where's that one from? Maybe I have.
So take a look into the Darkness lore. And that one is basically from doing... you pick up the little things across the moon that look kind of like the cryptex, except they're slightly...
Okay, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, so those give you entries of the Inquisition of the Damned book. And the reason why that's really awesome is because the Inquisition of the Damned gives us this, like, this ridiculous perspective of what's going on with the Hive right now. They're turning on each other, and it's basically a tale of three different groups of people. The first is of... the daughters of Crota, including Hashladun and her three other sisters. And it's like the Hive who are above and talking about how the Hidden Swarm is trying to rebuild itself using the sword logic, but there isn't really a worthy champion. There is another tale in that story from the pits down below where all the champions are sort of facing each other. And the final tale in this comes from the main characters of the book, which are a trio of Hive known as Azavath, Malkanth and one other whose name always evades me. It's very kind of like Lovecraftian names. Either way, those three, they basically look at the entirety of the Hive as being unworthy of the soul logic. And a small part of the reason for them kind of finding division between Hashladun and the rest of the swarm is because there's a cult of believers within Oryx's progeny, aka Crota's daughters, that basically believes they can summon him back. So it potentially identifies who that group of Hive is that could be trying to resurrect Oryx. And that's it's a really small thing, but it's really important because if it is the Hidden Swarm and specifically the Hive on the Moon who are trying to do this, it gives us a really good hint as to what's coming in the future, where the story of these Hive on the Moon in particular is gonna go. And I mean, I don't want to state anything too boldly about an activity that's not been released, because I mean, that could just be filling people with false expectations, but it potentially leads us into what could happen in the dungeon, because it is a great of the Hidden Swarm. But
it wouldn't be surprising if, I was glancing through while you were talking, speed reading, it wouldn't be surprising if some of the main characters or if going into the dungeon also involved going into the fighting pits that they mentioned and all that other stuff.
Yeah.
That wouldn't be surprised.
There's also,
but you're right.
Yeah. That book is fascinating. Generally, I encourage people to go
get that one.
Cause it's really cool. Like you've got this evolving story of like a plot from three siblings. But by that same token, it goes into some of the darkest mode. Like, you know, we talk about grimdark in a 40k sense, but this really is Destiny's version of true grimdark, you know? You're looking at a hive ceremony that involves one of the sisters killing another and ripping her soul out. And the way that she does that is by making her scream the death song until she no longer has vocal cords. Yeah, it's like
the hive
are like, you think you're hardcore? Well, yeah, no, this will challenge that notion.
That's freaking wild.
But the thing about that is then it gets even crazier, because when her vocal cords are done and her soul is in the hand of her sister, her brother gets mad and attacks, and his soul also spontaneously gets stolen in that moment, and then his soul is forced inside his sister's body. So you've got the soul of a knight who's all about aggression inside the body of a now completely Death Singer. And so it actually comes back to haunt the other hive. So this new Death Singer knight combo goes into the pit wielding two swords, one in each hand. And it's basically a wizard flying around with swords at this point. But you then suddenly see the result of that, which is they slaughter everything inside the they slaughter everything within the pit, and then they go all the way up to where the kind of hive ascendants are sitting. And everyone's like, wait, I recognize you. You're Malkanth's sister. But what? Where have you gone? And why are you wielding swords? And then she just butchers them all. Hachla Dune and a bunch of others just like run through the palace and start assassinating their political enemies. Because, I mean, at that point, everyone is falling into chaos. So why wouldn't you?
Exactly. It's the perfect moment.
Yeah. And like the entire thing just devolves entirely. And that's where our lore tab of it sort of ends, is back in the pit with the sister who performed the ritual and the brother kind of talking. The brother gets summoned back to her. And then she starts singing a more perfected version of the death song, I believe. And the person just can't hear.
Yeah.
They can't not hear, rather.
So speaking of the death song, is the death song simply just uttering the names of the worm gods? Like, okay.
So
because they frame things up. And I'm asking this question because if you're not someone who's going to read all the lore, you would be tricked into thinking that when you found whose ghost.
I know. So
one of the ghosts has an audio dialogue where the guy is going literally insane, chanting the names of
the Shrine of
Oryx. Exactly.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the death song itself is not that. I'm actually not sure what's going on with that ghost in particular and that particular recording. But what's really interesting about the death song is there's actually lore, again, in the Inquisition of the Damned book that comes up about that. I know, right? Like, it's this guy, man.
The one thing I didn't read.
I know, right? It's always that. Like, there's always something. To give you an idea, it's all in the two Unmaking parts of that book. Unmaking 1 and Unmaking 2. Basically, this is during the ritual, right? So let me go through and actually, like, I could read this, to be honest, because it actually gives you a lot of interesting context.
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, all right.
I would like that. And I'm sure everybody who's just going to listen to this would enjoy that context, too. And everybody gets to listen to Bife read something with his sultry tones, so folks will be happy.
Indeed. I'm going to sit back here at the beginning and hope that the game doesn't AFK boot me. If it does, rest in pepperoni, but such is the way of things. So yeah, of course, this is all still just going on in front of us, but this is the ritual that's being performed. You've got Malkanth performing this, and Azavath is the one who is having the ritual conducted upon her. So Azavath is the one who is dying, basically. Malkanth is the one that's extracting truth from her. And it's really important to know that Azavath has like this really well-tuned sense of what the death song is. And the kind of extraction of that is what this card touches on, because this is in the ritual.
Okay.
And it starts like this. Sing, O sister, of death and its many gifts. From the first, there has been war. Wars of the self, wars of conquest, wars of desperation, wars of greed. From war, death, from death, an end, from endings, beginnings. One such is now sung in the key of pain, Azavath's truth, the all of her torn free with a surgeon's grace. Malkanth's ears bleed as her sister's unmaking reveals her being. In the echoes of Azavath's scream, ancient histories reveal themselves. And then, from this point onwards, it just goes to a completely different section, and it talks about a story in four parts, which reveals the origins of the Death Song as something that was originally with the light, but then was twisted. So it starts as the Song of Life.
Tracks. Interesting.
Right? So that particular part reads, "The song was not always a corruption. It began as a gift, stolen from the gardener," which, for those of you who don't know, is a generic reference for the light. Right?
Yep.
"In efforts to understand the unknowable realities of the orb's incredible gifts, the signal was found, a repeating tune, the song of creation. Its frequencies were heard across the stars, wherever life's promise took hold. Some among the Ammonites worshipped it. Some among the Hive did the same." For those of you who don't know, the Ammonites were the first true race that were conquered by the Hive. They appear very early in the Books of Sorrow, and they were the first race that was ever seen to have received the Traveler. There may have been ones before them, but we don't know of them if they exist. Anyway, yeah. "Still others sought to control it, that they might cage it, that they might control it. For to control life is to control death. Such ambition was not new. Such ambition was as old as understanding. The melody was captured in studies. The frequencies replicated. But the orb's mysteries were not so easily brought to light. The song, for all its beauty, did not alone grant life. It was theorized that the song was not a song at all, but many. That within its refrain, untold rhythms spoke their truths, free and clear of the whole. Centuries passed. The song remained untamed. Life moved on." And then it moves on to the Song of Death part. And this is second of four. So, "The choir formed in celebration of the song." And you'll hear references to this choir later out in the kind of general part of these notes. And it talks originally about this choir that performs the Song of Life. And then eventually there is a choir that is formed around the creation of the Death Song. But yeah, that's kind of this bit here. "Performances marked the passage of seasons, but the song's lie eventually began to corrupt the spirit of those who heard its tune. The melody was a reminder, the orb was a catalyst, and the song was of the orb. Yet those who embraced the song were merely instruments and nothing more. Life remained beyond their grasp, while they remained ever in deaths. Those of the choir had given all of themselves. All was not enough. The first conductor was assassinated by one who sang an aria of her own making. She whose name has been stricken had found notes hidden in the frequencies. Reversed and mirrored in pitch, she weaved them together and sang her beautiful abomination until the conductor wept and bled and screamed and fell. The stricken fled, fearful of her crime, but others found promise anew in her art. The stricken was captured and subjected to inquisition so that her song might be understood. This was before understandings, before most things, when the first notes of a new song were written." So, yeah, you can kind of see what happened with the Death Song there, you know? Like, originally this was a thing of life, but after being flipped and twisted and honestly creating an abomination, the entirety of the Death Song changes. And so this leads us on to the next bit, which is, "In these notes, beautiful oblivion. The war had raged for centuries, one of many, just another, as irrelevant as the next. The stories of the choir and their death song were thought to be nothing more than folklore. Wholly untrue at best, vastly exaggerated at worst. They were demons who'd sought life's gift, only to corrupt its beauty. The homeworld of a species no longer on record, erased from the world's grave and thus from memory, as punishment for their transgressions, had kept itself safely removed from the battles being waged on the far side of the system. The location was safeguarded to protect the homeworld from the Hive's wrath. Its orbit was defended by an array of advanced offensive mechanics, cannons, mobile suits, mines, gravity slings, and more. They were protected. They were safe. They never noticed the small crafts slip through their defenses, 20 in total, landing in sequence at set coordinates along the planet's equator. 4 trillion souls were about their day and night as an unknown melody caught the breeze. It was beautiful, an ethereal gift and the end of all things. The choir sang, only 20 strong. As their voices grew in volume, the people started to scream. The planet's crust shifted and cracked. The seas roiled and spilled out over the land. The core shook. The ground shattered. Defenses scrambled. It was too late. Less than an hour after the song began, the hidden homeworld of a forgotten people split in twain. These are the song's powers, its gifts, anti-life, and oblivion. And the final part is rebirth, which kind of returns us to Malkanth. And this, of course, has all come from Azavath's mind. And so this is the truth that she kind of sees within the Death Song, gives us a potential look at its origin. And after that's all said and done, Azavath is very much dead.
Yeah.
So Malkanth braces as the pain of her sister's screams threatens to turn her mind to liquid. But she is strong and almost finished. Azavath's being was tied intimately to her purpose, to learn the song, perfect its notes, write her own aria, and become death. That she held so tightly to legends of the song's true power surprised Malkanth. Even Ur-Yut, one of Crota's most cherished, had long since given up on rebuilding the choir, yet Azavath was driven by this desire. Malkanth feels pride well up. Her sister, like herself, like her brother, all lesser in the eyes of those purer of bone, still nurtured ambitions beyond the festering cowardice of those who choose politics over action. The sword logic had failed them, but they would not fail the swarm. Malkanth makes her final cut. Azavath's roar shreds her throat and she falls silent, her body convulsing against the bolts, then becoming motionless. Ooh, return to orbit.
You made it.
2 seconds. I'll rejoin you in a second.
Sure.
Get back to it. Great way of going through the stream. Yada, yada, yada. Let's just shift all this down. Let's see. For an instant, Malkanth holds her sister's essence. She wishes to say farewell. But just as quickly, the wisp that was her sister sparks and blinks out. Malkanth recoils. Akrazul, Akrazul being the brother of these two sisters, who is a knight who is deformed, Akrazul jumps from his altar, lunging at Malkanth. Unflinching, Malkanth makes a single cut, deep, clean, tearing her brother's essence free from his physical self. Akrazul's body crumples to the ground. His soul is bigger and stronger than his sister's, angrier, meaner. For an instant, Malkanth worries Azavath's vessel will be unfit to contain their brother's rage. She shoves the severed knight's essence into Azavath's empty shell. Their sin is complete. Now come the consequences. So you kind of get an idea of what's going on with the Death Song there. You know, like entirety is studied by the Hive. There's this legend about a choir of the Death Song and how they can potentially come together and create an even more powerful version of it that is capable of literally cracking planets in half. You know,
does it concern you at all? or like get your brain all juiced up that there are these new emerging understandings that we have, not just about the Hive, but about the Vex and about the way that they have all of these things that seem like analogous, which has been since the beginning of the story, analogous to the power of the light. But now it seems that they're all kind of harnessing really similar information in order to do, whether it's experiments or to deconstruct or corrupt things like what the Hive does. Like, if the Death Song truly originally came from the Traveler, which we now know, and you start looking in some of the Vex lore, especially some of the stuff I was reading before, where you're kind of learning about Praedeath and how he went insane and all of these attempts that he had to communicate out of the vaults of glass and why we eventually got his gun and all that stuff. And he's experiencing, you know, time, and he's seeing the Vex learn these things and sing to each other and use a lot of these songs as, you know, or in their sense, frequencies, right? Because they're not out there singing with an actual voice to create. I think it's really interesting that we have this evil entity with the Vex that is really obsessed with creation and perfection and simulating things, attached as an enemy instead of as a friend. Like, obviously they have their own goals, but going all the way up to the very top with the discussion between the, you know, the winnower and the gardener, it's very obvious that the Vex are gardeners. Mm-hmm. And I find it concerning for how I want to view the Traveler. Like, does that bother you at all? Like, does that get you concerned?
So it only bothers me in so much as, like, it starts to expand on theory in a way that it potentially becomes sort of troublesome to understand for now. Other than that, I think a lot of it makes a lot of sense. So for starters, when you look back into the Grimoire card, you get the Grimoire card of Legends, the Black Garden, which comes from the perspective of a guy called Pujari, who's this warlock who actually has a lot of theory on the darkness and what it is. Pujari at one point states that he went to the Black Garden and that he jumped from the shores of time and actually saw, as he puts it, gardeners in vessels of bronze. So this is something that has definitely been sort of drawn as a conclusion before. Generally, the Vex of the Black Garden are seen as gardeners, which seems almost paradoxical because, I mean,
that was the word I was looking for. Paradoxical.
Yeah, they, yeah. Like, they worship the darkness, and yet they live in this place that is full of life, you know? And
yeah,
even if you look at Prince Aldrin's explorations of the garden, it's full of life itself. Am I too concerned about that? Not necessarily, but I feel like it leads into the greater purposes of what we don't understand about the Black Garden just yet, you know?
Okay.
I feel like the Vex in themselves were built to create a certain function and to fulfill a certain rule. However, I feel like that rule has been interpreted openly by the Vex as simply that they need to fulfill the end of the universe. That is, conquer the universe and be there at the end of it and be its ultimate masters. Now, here's the thing. All that is spinfoil and headcanon for me, so don't take it as fact.
Sure.
What I will definitely say, however, is that the greater intention of the Vex being there at the end of the universe is certainly a thing, if we're to believe Osiris, because he's also said stuff like that.
Yeah.
Shows us it in the Curse of Osiris campaign. But the actual, like, purpose that the Vex are fulfilling is questionable. The reason why they want to be there at the end of the universe, rather, is relatively unexplained. Like, their origin story is something that we genuinely are missing, because all we're told is that they're born in the Black Garden. But that apparently, according to the cutscene for the Season of the Undying, this wasn't the beginning, it was the reason. So
yeah,
that leaves a lot of questions still about the Vex in the garden. As for having the Vex as enemies, it doesn't necessarily, like, concern me as much, because I feel as though we will find out about it at some point in the future. And the Vex is still one of those really mysterious things. I feel like it's one of those last things where Destiny's not truly lifted the veil. Like, there's a lot of theory that you could potentially throw at it for it to make some sense. But even then, I don't know if I'd really want that right at this second, because I still want the Vex to be sort of preserved in mystery. Like, we know that the Vex of the Soul Divisive, the Vex in the Black Garden at least, they worship the darkness, right? And so that gives us kind of a very solid reason, I think, at least, to fight them. That's good. That's fine. But at the end of the day, I don't want that mystery of what the grander beginnings of the Vex were like spoiled until a little bit later. Now, it may come along in just a lore tab somewhere, but yeah, man, like, I'm totally kind of okay with this because it just leads to more questions. And I feel like that's really good. It's a good place for the lore to be, I feel, right?
There's
I'm going to jump back in on you when I've got a chance.
There is a very interesting numerical, I guess, I don't know the right word, uniqueness to the numbers that, and this is pertaining to the Vex still, the numbers that are cataloged for Praedeath's visions.
Are you talking about in the aspect tab?
Yes. Okay. So all of his Chromarians are all of the visions he's seeing trapped in the vault as he's falling into the river of time and experiencing everything all at once. They're all denoted with 227 dot whatever. And someone pointed out in my chat that 227 is actually an approximation of pi.
So I think there's a
22 divided by 7. It might be a reach, but I thought that it was interesting since we're talking about parallelisms between the Vex and the Traveler.
It's a really interesting potential tie-in for sure. Like pi and things like the golden ratio all being numbers that are intricate and complex and related to nature. But the 227 itself and Praedith's quote-unquote hallucinations, I don't believe are hallucinations. I think that they are actual people. So this goes all the way back.
Oh, I totally agree. Yeah.
This goes all the way back to the Vex Grimoire cards. So for those of you who are looking into Aspect, these are the notations, at least on my screen.
Yeah, I'll show on mine as well.
Here. Yeah, that Ben is talking about. The reason why 227 matters is actually because it relates back to the Ishtar Collective.
Okay.
So you remember that first mission with Dr. Shim and everything?
Yeah.
It's actually lore where him and his team... which I believe is, I need to find the name of the Irish guy because I always forget him. But yeah, so it's the team of Dr. Shim, Choima Essie, Maya Sundaresh, and the last guy who I know is listed in this card somewhere. Dwayne McNeve, I think. McNeve, yeah. Dwayne McNeve. So that whole team of four...
Yeah,
finds out during the study of a goblin that it's perfectly simulating them. And the problem with that is that if it's perfectly simulating them, the copies of the simulation might as well be them, right?
Okay.
So what they eventually do is they call in Rasputin and they separate the copies of themselves that have been simulated by the Vex from the real copies. And it turns out there are 227 simulated versions of their full team. And then unanimously as a whole body... they come along and they go into the Citadel, and those 227 simulated Ishtar Collective teams are released into the Vex networks to try and find out more about the Vex.
Mm.
And so the 227.18, I bet if you read back through those numbers, it doesn't go above 227 as its second number.
Yeah, it's all clearly like denotations of like, I'm tracking this particular subset of information.
Yeah, and when it talks about it, it's like 180 Maya Sundareshes and 145 Choima Essies both laugh. You know, it's like, it talks very clearly about these divisions of people. But it also shows like, hey, this is the copy and this is the number for that particular group. Like, it's talking about the simulations. And they're what find Praedith in the vault. And so all of those simulations plus Praedith, they're all planning to try and understand the Vex networks and get those messages about it out to the rest of us, which is really, it's such a fascinating concept because the entire thing just like, it hints towards the fact that, okay, to kind of spoil the end of the lore book, that Praedith has seen the darkness coming through the various timelines that he sees that are just utterly dark.
Yeah.
And that he's been trying to warn us about this. For those of you who don't know, No Time to Explain is an exotic pulse rifle in Destiny 1, which it seems very likely was referenced in Aspect, because it basically, there's an inscription on No Time to Explain that says, soon. And Praedith, in that lore book, goes through his thoughts saying, like, he needs to leave behind something, anything, to be set loose in the time stream. He figures a piece of equipment will be the best thing to attract Guardian Eye.
Because we stare at it all day.
Because it's loot, you know? And so on that piece of loot, he inscribes the word soon as a way of saying like, hey, the darkness is coming soon.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, I mean, again, if that is the same weapon, which it is unbelievably likely that it is, because, I mean, why would this be written with that intention otherwise, unless there's a grand deception already at play, which maybe keep in mind. The entire point of it is it gives context to No Time to Explain. It creates this amazing tie-in with a really cool lore story. Like, there's so much fantastic stuff that goes on in this lore book, and I just, Like, it's so much to keep in your head all at once. Plus, it talks about the Vex of the Black Garden more specifically.
Yeah, and how the other Vex are scared of them.
Yeah, how the...
And fight them.
Yeah, they fight, which is like amazing because I've never heard of them fighting each other.
Yeah, not just a baseline disagreement like you're dealing with a time stream in a way I find distasteful, but I don't care. It's like you're so f-ing scary, I need to kill you because you might hurt me. Yeah, like that's a weird interaction for Vex.
It's crazy too because you think about their unified purpose, like they have different divisions and different minds, but all of them seem to work towards a unified purpose, which is, it's amazing for the sake of their like synchronicity as a race, you know, like they never have disagreements. They're always on the same page for the most part. But when a disagreement so fundamental about how you get to that final state is made, that's where things get really intriguing. Like, what does that mean for the Vex? It means that all of a sudden a factor has entered play for them, namely the darkness that is so powerful that it's almost impossible for them to ignore it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that to me presents so many fascinating possibilities. It's really, really cool.
Yeah. And there's all this, what everyone's pointing out in my chat and where the conclusion is drawn is, ultimately, anyone who worships the darkness, as Temtek in chat pointed out, you know, it's all about pursuing the final shape.
Mm-hmm.
And this is actually a great transition into talking about the darkness. But so anyone who worships the darkness is seeking like the pinnacle of existence. They're seeking to become or assist the darkness in becoming the final true factor of the universe or the predominant factor of the universe, which is interesting because there's a lot of different ways to get there. Like you can go from your house to a store in a car. You could go on a plane, even though that might be impractical. You could go on foot. And so what I would like to know about all of these different groups, whether it's groupings of Hive or groupings of Vex, or anyone else, is what is the primary subdivision of, like, why is it so awful that group A wants to do this and group B wants to do this if the ultimate destination is the same? Because I don't think that their motivations have altered at all, regardless of what their approach is. You know what I mean?
As in everyone is serving the darkness, but by that same token, they're all trying to approach it in a different way.
They're all trying to create the final shape, but some of them are using axes and other ones are using stones.
So some of them, I don't know. So here's the thing as well, like worshipping the darkness and understanding the soul logic, I think are two things to be separated. Which is part of the reason why I think the Vex is so different still from the Hive. See, this is the thing about the soul divisive in particular. They encounter the darkness, and you've got to understand that when they do so, they see the darkness as something that they can't calculate, right?
Sure.
It's terrifying to them because they genuinely just don't have... they genuinely just don't have, like, a final win condition that they can easily predict because it's paracausal, much like the Traveler and the Light and the Guardians, right? So when they run into it, there's this moment of fight or flight for them. And in the case of many of the Vex, they flee. The difference between the Soul Divisive is they see a different possibility, which is that if it's so powerful that it could destroy us, why don't we just join ourselves with it? You know? And that creates this really interesting division, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they agree with the sword logic. It doesn't even necessarily mean that they understand it.
Yeah.
Take a look at a different group of Vex, such as Quoria, who see the inner workings of Quoria sees the inner workings of like Oryx's throne world and actually comprehends the sword logic, but in the end is taken and so doesn't really have a will of its own. So yeah, they serve the darkness, but by that same token, they don't really serve it out of their own free will. So it's an interesting one there. And they're not really truly connected to the Vex in the same way that everything else is.
Yeah.
The other thing to note as well is the difference between the Hive. Like the Hive, I think, are the closest to being true servants of the darkness, unless they're like some crazy darkness race that we don't know about yet.
Sure.
If there is, if people who are looking into the data mining and all that other stuff, like if you know stuff, just don't drop it here because for stuff like that. And I personally don't want to get spoiled, but yeah.
Same.
Point being, you've got like the Hive who not only understand the sword logic and worship the darkness, but actually put it into practice, right? So that's the real division. That's part of the reason why the enemies are still kind of fighting against each other. The darkness is using a ton of different tools to accomplish its aim. And I think that at some point in the future, there's a very good chance that we become one of those tools for that purpose. But I feel as though right now it is very much okay with the chaos that is caused by having different warring factions, you know? Like, at the end of the day, a weaker system of soul, one that has thrown the Cabal and the Fallen and humanity into chaos, is one that is much easier to conquer. And so, you know, it's much more about that united strength than it is about anything else, I feel.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they don't...
That's a nice war analysis from the desk of the darkness. No, that's actually... No, I mean, that's really solid game theory. If you confuse your true purpose, then it's really hard for your enemy to divine what it is.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is awesome, but also, since a lot of people are talking about it now, since we brought up the darkness, we have probably one of the most important pieces of lore that happened during this season when it comes to understanding the fundamental reality of the universe that Destiny exists in. So... if you don't know what this lore book is, and we could probably talk about this for 5 hours, but essentially the lore book real unveiling. Quick, yeah.
Spoiler warning before this. I know
big spoiler crazy, warning,
but yeah, this is the no, one thing it. We really want to do a spoiler warning.
Yeah, this is mega spoiler stuff. This is, you know, the artifact that we got through the quest. Is allowing the darkness to basically send communication directly to us and present its case. So one of the things when you're reading the unveiling, there's a few things I think you need to keep in mind when you're reading it. So if you haven't read it yet, go into it with this. One is the darkness talking directly to you. So it's going to be the purest form of its ideological expression, which means everything else is a corruption, right? What the hive is doing isn't, you know, because of the way that understanding and intelligence works, it's never going to be the exact intent of the author, right? So I would argue that everything is derivative, right? The way that the Vex are approaching things is derivative of its interaction. You could even make the argument that the the way Kallus acts is derivative of his interactions with the darkness, if that's absolutely what he met in the void. You know, the Vex. So everybody, Vex, Hive, Kallus, everybody who's had interactions with the darkness has heard most likely the same communication that the darkness is presenting us with right now via a vehicle that is incredibly common to it. So when Kallus went to the edge of the universe, maybe he met himself and that's how the darkness talked to Kallus. Like,
maybe he found one of these artifacts that then gave him this vision, right?
Exactly. There's a lot of really different ways it could have happened. But essentially, the darkness is presenting, first of all, what it actually is in a really elegant way and what the light is in a very elegant way. But so you need to pay attention that this is going to be the most true thing that you hear. And then number two, this is the place.
I question whether it's the most true thing, but it's definitely.
Well, this is the only source based information we've ever gotten about the darkness, direct communication. But because of that, I don't know if everything he's saying is true, which is what I meant to say. In fact, I would argue that there's a lot of things in there that you can learn and probably take out as fact. But you need to be really careful when you're reading it to not let the logic of the darkness seem flawless. And that's the thing is cloud your judgment. So basically, like, whenever you're talking to a philosopher that fundamentally believes in their philosophy, they're going to advocate for it in a very strong way that's going to be logically cohesive. And they're going to tell you a story wherein which that makes sense. And that is exactly what the darkness does when it's talking about the flower game. One of the things I thought was really interesting is that the darkness and the light are self-aware ontological concepts of the multiverse.
Right. which is awesome because it's
which
like,
is yeah,
you sit there and you think like, yeah, of course they are, man. Like, because like at the end of the day, there's a lot of stuff in this book that just makes everything fit really neatly.
Yes. That's
part of the reason why it's kind of hard to trust, but also part of the reason why it's so wonderfully fascinating, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it fits with Ulan Tan's symmetry theory, where it states that the universe has and always must be two halves, a yin and a yang of light and dark, right?
Like, yeah.
It's such a cool thing when you look at the Pujari's theory, talks about it, and how the darkness is an absence of morality. And, you know, everything that you read previously about darkness can fit really neatly within this book. But, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, so if you haven't read the book, essentially, the darkness, because it knows that it is a sentient ontological construct of the multiverse, uses a parable to talk to you. And inside of this parable, we find out about the relationship, or at least how the darkness understands its relationship with the light. And we can get into that later. But basically, the darkness saw itself as the ender of things, or the winnower, in this garden, whose job it was to clean up things after they had died in this game. And the light's job was to plant things in this game so that things could grow. And then after doing their core functions, they just let the game execute itself. The darkness goes on to tell us a story about how the light had a fit one day and got angry at how boring the game was and maybe destroyed a universe in its fit by slapping it with a towel.
If we're to interpret flowers as universes, but yeah, that's
possible. if we're interpreting this as the flowers as universes, that's how I've contextualized things in my head. But it, you know, it destroyed something that wasn't supposed to. And that's when the darkness decided it was time to intervene. And that's, at this point, the most recent lore entry, if I'm not wrong, is the first knife.
Because
the one I got this week was blanked out. So I assume that means.
I want to say that the one that's the next week's one, but it's not.
Okay.
Yeah. Cause again, cool. We've been able to pull some of these entries in advance because Destiny's systems were not supposed to let us do that, but multiple characters exist.
I did not know that.
Hence why they're but either way, the first knife doesn't give a huge amount of detail on stuff like that.
It doesn't give any detail other than the darkness discovered a weapon in what it was using. And this is where I think things get really interesting, right? So you can see the bias of the darkness when it talks about the light, about it's a petulant, bored child. Mm-hmm. Or like a whiny couple, like a whiny partner. Right? Like, that's how it presents the light, as someone who is incontent with the way the game works, and the darkness thinks that the game is just fine. What I think is interesting is that inside of its admission that it looked down and discovered that it had the ability to shape the universe with a tool it was simply using to tend to it, sort of to me is it's like an admission of guilt. The entire parable to this point has been the darkness strictly abiding by the rules. And once it saw the light break the rules once, I feel like it's saying, hey, I'm going to break the rules too and advocate for my purpose.
So this is where the book kind of tails off and ends. But the really interesting thing is, again, like the entry just before First Knife, the one that we should have gotten this week, it talks specifically about how the Traveler is dissatisfied. And it literally says, I'm going to go and make a new rule. Right.
Yeah.
And it's it's a drastic move because, again, if this is to be believed, the darkness and the light exist within the bounds of the universe. And this is the way it's always been. So this is like the most fundamental change. This is equivalent to, if you'll permit me to use a religious analogy, this is equivalent to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, who were...
It's a creation story. Yeah. Well, it's not a creation story. It's an existence story because they always existed.
Yeah. So this is equivalent to them being corrupted for the first time. You know, this is the point at which Eve takes the apple from Lucifer. This is the point at which she's convinced to eat the fruit of the knowledge. So yeah, like the entirety of it just sort of revolves around this change, if we're to believe the darkness's story. And again, like whether you believe that or not is something that I think you should really decide for yourself, because it provides a lot of convenient truth, but it also has this really very deliberate point of being something that you might not want to trust. You know, this is another thing, kind of like the Allegiance quest, that is going to split Guardians down the middle, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm personally of the side of, we can't trust this. Some other people are probably going to be like, hey, you know, darkness and light, these two are just concepts. This is a pure explanation of what's going on. I think this is trustworthy. Whichever side you take, I think that's fine. I think the most important thing is to keep an open mind with this, because A, the story is still unfolding, and B, we just don't know enough, you know?
Yeah.
Like, they talk about the beginning of the universe, and they talk about the necessity of darkness, and like, this lore book generally gives us some of the most fascinating potential insights that we've ever had into Destiny.
Yeah.
But by the same token, you are looking at something that is highly suspect. Like, it's impossible not to think of it like this. So yeah, just keep that in mind, you know? Like, we are beings of light that are potentially being played by a being of the darkness.
Yeah. And I, to you know, so far, you know, our desire to grow stronger has led us to make a few mistakes. And if the Oryx lore or new lore is to be believed, perhaps that's the simplest way for the darkness to manipulate us, is to just get us to kill everything that might protect us. And then upon us killing it, it becomes corrupted, much like the Death Song. We create a corruption of something that we wanted, and then that thing lives stronger or creates more problems for us. Which is, again, in game theory, the another great way to win a war is to manipulate your enemy into destroying themselves. What I find really interesting about the darkness story is that, because when I was reading through it the first time on stream, everyone was like, wow, the light's an asshole. And I was like, yes, that is exactly what the author wants you to think, right? Like, the darkness wants you to assume that the light is full of and it's breaking the game.
And it's also, and why did it have to change the universe from the way it was originally intended
exactly
to be?
Like,
what's wrong with the universe as it was meant to be, right?
Mm-hmm. Also, and this is a fundamental logical assumption that goes unstated, but you are assuming that the game that the darkness and light exist in, all right? Because remember, it's, they're not actually playing a game.
This is,
that is an analogy.
Right?
It's a metaphor. Or to borrow religious again, it's a parable. So in this parable, the fundamental assumption is that the game, one, must exist, and two, in its existence is already correct and requires no guidance, which is immediately violated logically by the fact that the Winnower and the Gardener have to be present to take care of the game. So my thought is that the darkness is presenting itself as a sentient concept of the universe that simply exists, which clearly it exists on a level we don't understand. But from argumentation, I think you could make the point that it is violating its own construct by saying this game has to exist and I have to take care of it, but the game's already perfect. My concern is that any intervention in the game inside of the parable is actually a violation of the game's perfection, which means that the game is not fair from the beginning, which means we actually don't know which side is correct. It's a long way to get there, but that was my biggest takeaway, was I don't trust in the fidelity of the game that's being described.
Right. So that's exactly kind of it. I mean, I suppose it's not exactly where I came to, but I came to a very similar conclusion, which is this assumption that the game in itself basically works on the laws of sword logic, if you think about it, right? Like, it talks about how
described.
It talks how during the day the gardener plants things, and that during the night the winnower would reap the crop and see what would survive. And it uses those very specific, very important words, what would be worthy of surviving, you know, like what would live. That is sword logic 101, you know, only the strong survive. So if you sit there and look at it, the darkness is communicating here, and it's very much framing the game at the very beginning of time as being one of its own kind of rules. It's saying it's the one that creates order, effectively. It's applying it to it, whereas the darkness created the light created disorder, you know? So
oh,
Oh, I totally missed this, Mike. Holy.
Okay, keep going. Yes. I think I know where you're going with this. Keep going.
So it's basically framing it around that concept of I was always correct in the first place, and the light is just, you know, it's just basically breaking the rules. Here's the thing about that. This is everything that the darkness is sitting there and telling us. It's very much stating from a first assumption that the actual principles of the universe are based upon the sword logic and not the bomb logic, or just neither of them. The existence just is, perhaps, you know?
Like, yeah.
It's stating a baseline set of rules and principles for the universe without giving some kind of backup to them. It even just says, simply because this was, you know, this is the way it's supposed to be. Which, fundamentally, I don't trust, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it is really hard for me to sit there and accept plain principles from the very beginning of the universe. And even when the Traveler, if it ever so decides to just go ahead and do this as well, drops its principles and theory, I'm going to have to take the same skepticism, because both of these will be biased viewpoints, you know? Like, you're sitting there and you cannot look at this with any level of objectivity if you believe that one is correct over the other, you know? Like, maybe there is truth in both stories if there are similarities, but at the end of the day, I don't think I trust either of them completely with this. This is very clear that there's perspective and opinion here,
you know? Yeah.
And that's, of course, if there's similarity in any of their stories, which, you know, maybe there is, maybe there isn't. But, you know, like, it basically, this entire thing paints the darkness as the one that was following the rules from the first principle, because the rules of the universe, according to it, are the rules of the darkness, right? Only the strong should be allowed to live. And again, I disagree with that, because I think that's making a bold claim about the nature of the universe from first principle, you know?
Yeah. So the other thing, and you didn't say this, but I think it's important to note.
I think I know where you're going, but go for it, go for it.
Is that for an entity that is incredibly obsessed with things functioning properly and being clean and working out logically and having order, it certainly uses chaos a lot.
Right.
Which is antithetical to its own statements about itself. And that could be, inside of that could be its expression of its logic, right? Like, now that you've f***ed everything up, of course it's crazy until I fix it.
Mm-hmm.
But we actually
clean knife edge, you know,
until the game has reached its final shape, which, again, who's to decide that? And the game that, when they're describing the game in parallel, they're in parable, the game, the flower game, lasts forever. Mm-hmm. So it can't have a final shape.
Right.
Which was another thing. That was the other thing that stood out about the logic of the parable that really confused me. Because he's seeking a final shape for a game that generates swirling galaxies and, you know, gigantic dead zones and all of this other stuff that happens in the flower game. But to the assumption that along this infinite plane of flowers, there's going to be some sort of ultimate final shape in its infinity, you can't trust it. That defies the logic and structure of the game to me. And I think it's important to look for cognitive like dissonance or bias like that when you're analyzing someone's work, because it can speak to where they are inserting their opinion.
So kind of on that note, I feel as though the perfect final shape that they reference in this is just the nature of the game as it starts, right? Like, that's, I think, what they're trying to state, because it always corrects itself to that state. And then, you know, it always ends the same way, which if you look at the sword logic, the darkness will always end the same way with regards to the universe. Like, the strongest will always be the victors. And there's no room for anything interesting or diverse, which is really the kind of problem that the Traveler sort of brings forward. So when you look into all of that, I think that's what's really kind of important to know. I think that it goes back to the way the darkness is framing everything. It's framing everything as though the universe was just kind of almost perfect in its eyes, you know, like the game just played out and it simply was, you know, there's no implication of anything even being wrong, because at this moment in time, maybe there's no conception of what right or wrong is as far as discord is concerned, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that the game as the darkness describes it, is supposed to be, and this kind of leads me again to that conclusion of like, I can't trust it. You know, I think it's supposed to be this idea of, hey, this is the darkness and this is what it's doing. And, you know, this is the final shape as the universe dictates it. And it's always been this way. And again, I just don't, I fundamentally don't trust that. Because again, it implies a lot of stuff about the beginning of the universe that we just don't know to be true. Like, yeah. By that same token, you can say the same thing for light. Yeah, I'm still left in fundamental disagreement about a lot of it, you know?
Yeah. The one thing that you can take away about the light, I feel like with a safe certainty is it is of an equivalent level of existence and strength as the darkness. Like, the darkness talks about it like a companion. Like a friend.
Like an equal, right?
Like an equal, yeah. And the first time I was reading through this, everyone was like, oh, well, like, you know, like, well, the light looks like an asshole. And then the second one was like, well, how can we even, like, how do we even trust the light? Or like all this other stuff. And like, maybe he's lying. I thought it was really interesting because in a space where the author could very easily kind of reach out and strongly decry the level of like power or existence or strength that his adversary has, it doesn't. It's very complimentary. Like it there's the only digs that start happening at the Traveler are in its behavior, or the light is in its behavior towards the game later on, which are completely totally unsubstantiated.
Yeah, plus like, it's very eloquent and very kind of, I want to say almost surgical about it, you know, like it doesn't say the Traveler was enraged. It says the Traveler was vexed, which is just a very eloquent way of saying they got angry. And then when it talks about the actions of the Traveler, they quote it, you know, they don't make any assumptions about the nature of the Traveler, or they don't say like it cried like a little baby. Look at this little guy. What the? It goes ahead and is like, you know, it simply said this. And I replied, and then it did this. You know, it's leaving its actions to be what you have that judgment from. So yeah, like that's part of the reason why I think the writing is as good as you say it is, man. Like, it's the same kind of principle.
Well, they're using like, and the other thing that I really enjoyed when I was reading about it is you can sort of see the logical underpinning that every race you combat corrupts. Like the different ways to seek the final, like the hive are seeking it solely by destroying everything that isn't them or isn't strong enough to survive. And they are kind of gladiatorial in that sense. Like, if you kill me, I'll stay dead.
Yeah.
Like if you figure out how to actually kill me, sure, I'm dead. But in any other format, you're dead. And you should have been dead permanently because, you know, I exist. And you can also see, you know, the way the Vex corrupted or any of this other stuff, which I really liked. My concern after reading all of this is if these two beings, entities, or powers have always existed, and if there's always shadow and there's always light, maybe the only way to fix all of this is to just turn it all off.
Mm-hmm.
Which would mean that we would destroy the darkness and we would destroy the light. And then everything would go back to the way that it was.
So it's at this point that I refer to another really nerdy science fiction property. Have you ever watched Babylon 5?
I've not watched Babylon 5. Holy,
okay.
I really need to. Everyone tells me I need to. So I'm familiar with the universe.
It's wonderful in terms of just everything, because you're going to experience the beautiful computer animation in 240p, and it's glorious. And yeah, there's a lot of love to be had for that, just from the generation it's from. But the reason I bring it up is because there's a bigger kind of, I won't do too many spoilers for people who haven't seen it, but there is a bigger war at play than the main characters and the main kind of factions within the universe initially portray. And the bigger war is effectively between a protagonist and an antagonist that then sort of turn against each other, and then they both become antagonists, kind of. And then it's left after that to, they basically end up leaving the universe, and they leave the younger races, who are not part of them at all, and are much more understandable because these other two entities are just like vast and kind of
really
hard to discern. Yeah, they basically just leave those younger races to make the world for themselves. And that, I feel like, if you take a look at Destiny's grand journey, one of the ways they could play it to continue the universe is that we as Guardians are the quote-unquote younger races. We are those difference makers. And we basically just start this entire thing.
Okay.
This process of the darkness and light disbanding, kind of. We still end up keeping our powers because video game.
Sure.
But, you know, they basically stop their grander war and we say we choose our own path. We do not choose to be defined by the sword or the bomb logic. We choose our own existence, you know? Which I think would be a really neat way of tying all these, like, different bits together, at the very least. But, I mean, whether that ends up working out nicely or not, it's, you know, we'll see. But again, I feel like that's a
potential... I've got folks super, super curious about what the bomb logic is.
Okay, so, basically, everyone kind of
also, knows. Hi, Raiders, hello.
Oh, Raiders, yay. So, to give you an idea of what the sword logic is, I really need to explain the bomb logic. If you want a much more in-depth explanation of all of this, my best recommendation for you is go and read the Mara Senna and the Awoken of the Reef book, because they give you a really good explanation, which is way more in-depth than mine. But, to give you the basic version of it, bomb logic is to sword logic as light is to dark, right? Okay. So it kind of goes back to that first principle argument between the darkness and the traveler that you see within the garden, right? The winnower sits there and is a fan of life and is a fan of complexity. And the main complaint about the game that they have is that it always ends the same way, right? Which, you know, is understandable because the patterns then eventually become boring. And, you know, that's a point of view, admittedly, but still. The darkness, on the other hand, is fine with the game because it always ends with the strongest outcome being the winner, and it always ends the same as a result. Bomb logic and sword logic are kind of a reflection of that. Sword logic is basically saying the mightiest will survive, and it's really simple, and it's saying you claim victory by following that doctrine and by proving your strength over the rest of the universe and making them basically not exist. Bomb logic is the light's equivalent of that, and it says that instead there is strength from diversity. And there is strength that you can gain, strength that is gained not just through that diversity, but also from the complexity that that brings. So the reason why it's called bomb logic links into this, because if you deconstruct all the parts of a bomb individually, they are nothing. You know, they are useless. Like a trigger is nothing if it's not connected to a detonator and to an explosive and all this other stuff. But when you link them all together, they become really, really powerful. And this is kind of what they play with in the Mara Senna. Like, when you go back to seeing Mara's vision of Oryx, she sees that there is a sword that cuts her and, like, basically takes her from the universe. But she discerns that there is a way that she can beat this, which is by using that attack as part of a more complex plan and allowing herself to then survive so that she can then strike back. And this plays into that part where the light basically builds more complex plans. When you take a look at that in particular, Mara's plan eventually becomes sit there within Oryx's own throne world until I can be reborn and I can make it back to the shores of Elysinia. But in the process, her big part of the plan was to help destroy the Hive fleet. And so she is basically counting on the Guardians to be another part of that. Mm-hmm. In this sense, her death is kind of like Oryx adding his sword to the mechanism of the bomb, and she literally talks about his sword as if it was the trigger for the explosion to go off, right?
Mm.
So it's this one thing of like, the sword logic may just be about, hey, kill something, dominate it, and you've proven your simplicity. But the light plays games within the game of the sword logic, right? So you can sit there and you can become way more powerful if you potentially conquer that one version of the game that you're playing. It's a really complicated way of explaining it, but basically, it's all boils down to complexity versus simplicity.
Yeah.
The light believes in complexity and the darkness believes in simplicity.
Yeah. It continues the symmetry, right?
Yeah.
And the more, like, the warlocks love that word, by the way. symmetry is great, but there's, you know, always symmetry in the way things are expressed. And so essentially, and this is a question in chat, and I think it's really good because the philosophical underpinnings of sword logic are sort of ingrained into all of Western civilization. So it's really easy for us to understand that the big man with the biggest weapon is probably going to survive if he wants to kill everyone else. What is more difficult to understand is the idea that complexity and diversity breed greater strength. So to again pull on a biblical reference, it's David and Goliath. Goliath had one very strong aspect: size, strength, clear winner, biggest stick to in the room, right? And David had a slingshot, which is something that in and of itself, a a string of leather with a pocket in it and a rock from a river all among themselves do nothing. But in that interaction, it resulted in the end of a war. Dude, so
that is perfect. I wish I'd come up with that. That's, dude, that's actually a perfect way of describing it. Yeah.
Yeah. So it is incredibly reductionist to assume that something's simplest form might be its most useful or beneficial. All of the parts in your computer in and of themselves don't do anything. And if you reduce them to their elements, like a pile of silicon and a pile of, copper and gold, that's not going to do shit. But if you put it together in the right way, it can think faster than your brain. So the complexity of the universe that the light is, advocating for, the back end of this logic is, if you take the parts of the universe, you can construct different things with them that may ultimately become more powerful than the individual parts by themselves. And that's really easy to understand under that concept. So it is really, man, that's super fucking interesting.
Yeah.
So hopefully that sort of breaks things all of the way down into like two simple constructs so you can understand, what you're advocating for. And when you look at them that way, suddenly this idea of the strongest things must survive doesn't necessarily make a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. And it does. And it begins to evolve away from this idea of, well, things living is good and compassionate and all this other stuff, even if it makes life more hard, which is sort of what I think people's default response to the narrative is. Oh, well, they exist. It's just like, Thanos. People are like, they already exist. They deserve to go on existing.
Right.
And obviously there are people that totally agree with Thanos' logic. And if that's you, that's fine. But the complexity of the universe allows for greater diversity, which is greater diversity and greater strength, which is the polar opposite of what the darkness is trying to advocate for. So now maybe if you were feeling empathetic towards the darkness, you understand the pursuit of what the traveler and the light is trying to do logically. I get sword logic is like a philosophy whose ideology has a something that transcends and enters the realm of ontological effects and theories. Okay, so both of these things in the Destiny universe have ontological expression, right?
Yes.
Expressions on the fundamental level of existence,
Like you exist, therefore you have to have some kind of relation to these two properties because you have a relation to existence and to death and the end of existence,
Yeah, exactly. And this brings up something super interesting. Someone wanted me to bring this up since we're talking about the Vex a lot. The ghost fragments, ghost passage in D1, where they talk about, where the ghosts are talking about how they don't understand what they do to bring guardians back. And there's some symmetry, if I'm remembering it right, there's some symmetry to the ghosts guessing at maybe we are as Vex are, and we simply copy and paste a guardian from another timeline who didn't get shot in the head by that bullet. I was just curious what you thought about that in relation to, what we're talking about for ontological concepts.
That's super complex.
It is really complex, but I mean, that's why I like talking to you, because we get to get there at the end.
So could you explain that again? Because I'm honestly like I'm struggling with the
memory effect. Nacho, could you post it so we could just read it and then go from core text instead of memory?
This is I want to say I'm very glad that you've bamboozled me in the sense of you've got a grimoire card or a lore entry that I can't remember. Because that concerns me slightly, because I feel like I should remember this.
Yeah, Nacho's gonna grab it really quick so we can read it. But yeah, like essentially, and this is to buy some time while he's posting this. Essentially, this is where some people come up with the theory that the Traveler may or may not be a Vex construct, because they say, oh, well, this is this ghost and it's talking about how maybe we're using technology similar to the Vex, and the Traveler is, of course, looks incredibly technological and complex, which I think at this point is kind of a logical fallacy now that we've seen the Darkness ships, which also look very logical, which also look very complex once you go inside. I also think it's very interesting that the bomb logic by default undermines everything about sword logic, because as things can get more infinitely simple, they also still embrace the complexity that makes them. Like, a sword is made up out of molecules,
right?
And like, you can, if you're going to drill to the underpinnings of the universe, everything is essentially made up of many things, which is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're waiting on this. The Reapers are coming.
I'm so fascinated by that, because again, I'm sure I'm struggling to remember this, and I'm gonna look at it and then it's like, okay, I remember this.
Yeah.
But yeah, dude, there's such a fascinating whole bunch of stuff that we just don't know with regards to the Traveler and its relation to all the different races. So if there is something that points towards it being a Vex construct, like, that's kind of incredible.
Yeah.
Again, that's all, I don't wanna put my, here's the thing.
No, yeah. Well,
the minute I sit there and I say something in a video or put my thumb in, instantly people go along and it's like, it's a thing. It was totally confirmed. Yeah. It's not always confirmed. Like, just let it be. Like, just let your stuff do its things and just wait and find out. I'm really
Nacho. Is this the one where the ghosts talk about reviving guardians, or is that a separate one? Because I also want to talk about that if this isn't it. But yeah, so this is the ghost fragment ghosts. It says, beyond. It is a place casting shadows and emotion. It is a real place, I know. One hot blue sun and other suns too. Five? I like seven better. That's what I'm recalling, is a giant star with a family of six smaller suns, and you could spend days and nights counting all of the planets circling those suns, especially, except there are no planets, not anymore. The powers in charge have carved up all of the worlds, maybe a brown dwarf or two for good measure. And with that rubble, they fashioned a topologically creative enclosure, a twisting space and time sealed behind doors, admittedly, that admit only those who know the magic words. The bones of hundreds of planets have been cut smooth and laid out like a floor, a polished and lovely floor, creating vast living spaces. A floor bigger than 10,000 worlds, catching the fierce glory of the seven suns for light, for food, for beauty, and nothing escapes. No heat, no gravity, not even the faintest proud sound. It could be anywhere. It can live in the cold between galaxies or folded up inside matter near enough to touch right now. I remember it, and maybe it's exactly as I described, seven suns wrapped inside magic. Or maybe it's something less entirely, a place still fat with life, an abundance of sentient souls, some decent, maybe some of lesser quality, and everybody stands about or floats about, or they bounce between dimensions. The point is that the residents of this hidden realm live inside a bottle so perfectly hidden that they can't see beyond their own borders, which shapes a mind in very specific ways. But beyond is their name for a mysterious, doubtful realm that they can't see, which is us, of course. Mm-hmm. So that's not the one where they're talking about reviving each other, but that is interesting. It's the card that was referenced in the new lore book After, oh, it's the card referenced in the new lore book after saying we missed an old puzzle.
Which new lore book is this? Is this Aspect, maybe?
Yeah. Nacho digs deep into the lore too. Yeah, it's, so this is...
It's a fascinating entry, and I do remember this one, but
so at that's the time
when this was released, it was so... It was so, like, obscure. Like, this one, yeah.
Oh, it's in the foreword in the Grimoire Anthology.
Okay.
Right. Okay, yeah. So, yeah, Nacho, if you could get the lore book where the ghost is talking about, like, maybe we copy and paste things, that would be cool, too, because I'd like to talk about that from a point of reading the text. But yeah, I mean, that is, so that's the ghost that they find outside the Vault of Glass. And I think that originally when you read that, you think, oh, the Vault of Glass is the perfectly hidden bottle, or, you know, the pocket universe that Atheon might be trying to create. But as we get like more context to the story, I wonder if maybe it isn't talking about us. Which is like a logical thing that I think about for the Guardians a lot, is that we are resurrected into a world with no memories, and then we are told how that world functions. And if everyone wanted to lie to us, they could.
Yeah.
And this has the, this also has resistance to like the first mover fallacy. All it takes is one person lying to the first Guardian who showed back up. And if that Guardian perpetually exists, that lie becomes a truth. Mm-hmm. Yes. So it's very, There are some very big holes that you can punch in like our understanding as Guardians, because we are agents of light, operating on a restricted set of rules. The ghost is the bad guy. No. That's not what I'm saying. Okay. Yeah. So it's really interesting. All of that stuff that's spoken in of and about there about the lights and the universes. And so we don't really know the place that's being referenced there yet, because we haven't gone there. A place with a glowing blue star, or at least that I can remember.
There is a note. I need to look at this and double check, because what I'm about to talk about is literally the craziest, spinfoiliest nonsense.
That's great. If
you go outside the Vault of Glass, there's a red box.
Sure.
Which is also talked about in the lore, and it's talked about in the context that if you look inside it, you can see almost a perfect copy of our solar system. I want to double check on that at some point, but it makes me think of that at very least. It makes me sit there and think back to a perfectly folded space, you know? Like, it sounds really similar.
But interesting.
Yeah, I can't make a definitive link, but that's what it reminds me of instantly, at least.
Yeah. I mean Atheon's mailbox. History is all about, yeah, okay, so here's the no res for the weary thing. So to give it context, when we're because one of the things that I think we're learning more of is we're obviously learning more about the darkness's relationship with the Traveler, which, and more of how the Vex operate and how the Hive operates. So when you look back at some of these other lore entries, they have new context. So no res for the weary. This is from the Ghost Stories book. It got added into Forsaken. My guardian is immortal. My guardian is forever lost to me. He boarded the derelict Almighty with his fire team, hoping to salvage Cabal secrets from the Star Murderer. Great. This is just great dialogue.
Which is accurate for what the Almighty is, but yeah.
Exactly. I should have seen the trap. Was it Cabal? Maybe it was some sort of Vex infection from Mercury. I don't know. It's all my fault. I remember the moment of activation felt like falling. He lunged for the center, crying out to his friends, "I'll disarm it." He's still lunging, flying to the Almighty, and you would find him there, caught in the amber of slow time, reaching forever. I have observed his motions carefully. He will arrive at the mechanism and deactivate the trap in only a little more than 50,000 years. I cannot resurrect him. I have tried so hard. The city's warlocks and Thanatonauts have answered all my desperate questions, even when I began to ask if he could be destroyed. At least if he were gone, unmade, I could make him again. Why can't I bring him back? If a Guardian falls in Titan's methane sea, they do not die instantly, but they still bring back, but we can still bring them back in the Arcology. If a Guardian hurls themselves off of a ship into space, do we need to wait for them to disintegrate in the solar wind before we bring them back? No. No. It was never hard before. I see him right there and he seems so close. All I was ever meant to be was his ghost. But all ghosts know that there are places we cannot bring our guardians back to life. And this is one of them. Why? Is the darkness gathered here against us? Is the light too weak? I think I know why. Some share my theory. What do we do to bring guardians back? What is the magical heart of the process? Are we like the city's probability kilns, twisting quantum vacuum into our favor to yield matter? Perhaps, perhaps. But a certain member of a cult I shall not name have their own specific interpretation of the process. When you bring him back, they told me, you must have a template, an image to provide you with the information you need. Where do you find that template? Simply in a neighboring timeline, a place where he is still alive and intact. And wherever there is great danger and the probability of death is too high, those timelines become scarce and hard to reach. So you find the zones where guardians cannot easily be remade. If this is true, then I am doomed and free. There will be no alternative worlds in which my guardian escapes the trap, and there is no hope of resurrection. I will be a ghost alone. But the thought haunts me that I might be wrong and that he is still waiting for me. So that's one of the places where you hear the author, a ghost, discuss how it doesn't know how it does its job. And one of the alternate theories.
So they pull guardians from other timelines.
From other timelines. So they scan probability fields and snatch a guardian that didn't get, you know, disintegrated by Kallus and, you know, bring back one that was going to fight to victory. So they're like 3D printers, more like 4D printers.
Yeah.
Or like 5D.
Which dimension is thought based upon, right? You
know? Like, probability is technically the fourth dimension. So they would be a fourth dimensional printer.
That is awesome.
Yes. Or they have the ability, they would have the ability to read separate timelines. I can't remember. I read a book about how to construct a dimension. It's either fourth or fifth. If you're interested in dimensional research, chat, there's a thought experiment that got turned into a book called Imagining the 10th Dimension. It's got like a really cool YouTube video that you can go watch. It's like 20 minutes, but it's really cool. And I mention it because it's incredibly helpful in understanding some of the really heady timeline discussions that happen around Destiny. Time is the fourth dimension, so probability is the fifth. So they're fifth dimensional printers. Got it. Thank you, Chad. I knew you'd get me out. Yeah. So it's really interesting that the ghosts don't understand how they're doing what they're doing. And it would make sense that they're being empowered by the Traveler to do something that would technically violate the rules of the game, which is introduce forms of complexity almost continuously to arrive at a different final shape by continuously interfering with the game and only selecting the outcome that it desires by allowing us to be, you know, ontological warriors. Yeah, yeah. We just exist.
Resurrect, yeah. And ignore causality.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. So it's been a long time since I've heard No Res for the Weary. I was very, very... I'm not going to lie as well. When I first read that, I completely discarded it because I was like, well, it's just the ghost is theorizing.
It seems really...
discredit, really, because now that that's been brought back, it's like, ooh, interesting.
Yeah, it's like recontextualized a little bit.
I think the other thing as well that's worth noting is they talk about a cult within the city, correct?
Yep.
Okay, so I don't want to immediately jump to conclusions, but the one thing that comes to mind for me, at least, is the cult of the Trinary Star, which is a cult that, interestingly enough, to weave things into all of this, states that the Traveler is in fact, tied to the darkness because it brought upon us the collapse after the Golden Age, because it led the darkness here. Which is really interesting, because if you look at the probable beliefs of the Trinary Star and saying, you know, traveler bad, yada, 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 not only would pulling from other timelines imply that it violates order, much in the same way the darkness kind of says that the new rules to the game the traveler wants to create would violate the order as well. They also just generally have a distrust of the traveler, and that generally leads you into this point where if you are looking at what ghosts are, and if you try and link everything together, there is this kind of interesting question with, is the darkness correct? Have the rules been violated so that ghosts can do this? You know, there's just a lot of interesting tie-ins, I feel. Sorry, I feel like I'm suddenly a little out of my depth. Is that
no,
crazy?
It's, I mean, no. that's like what we're supposed to do, right? Swim in the deep end?
Yeah, no, that's fine, that's fine.
No, and that's, I mean, that's the thing. And big shout outs to Nacho Otter, who's one of my mods.
Yes,
thank you, Nacho. You know, he's a huge lore nut, and he's very obsessed with Vault of Glass. So, you know, he tends to bring up stuff that's referential to any lore around that when it pops up in game. So, I mean, to me, it would be continued affirmation of the darkness's big gripe if that's what ghosts are doing, right? Mm-hmm. They are taking information from one of the flowers that technically should remain a self-sustained entity and interjecting it into another one of the flowers, allowing it to live or violate the principles of the game. Which, by the way, one of the most elegant statements in that whole parable is the darkness does a really, really good job laying out how complex this game is that they're sort of caretaking. And then is quick to remind you at the end, by the way, this game that I just described to you is infinitely less complex than what's actually happening, because what's actually happening is, as a sun, it would be like comparing the seed
to a sun that gives it life and yeah, everything else around it. Yeah.
Which, like, if you think about the orders of complexity between a seed and a sun, it's pretty massive.
On level of how many molecules there are alone.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jeez.
Nacho says he's good buffs with Owen and Lando. The MOTS Owen. Guys, he'll know.
Oh, is what yeah, he said. Owen. Owen and Lando are from the Music of the Spheres team. They're really good people.
Yeah.
Owen, I believe, was actually, yeah, I remember seeing a thread with him on Twitter where he was actually very excited about all the new Death Song stuff, because that actually, again, links in potentially with Music of the Spheres. You could potentially have a little bit of headcanon there that the Music of the Spheres is kind of the equivalent to the Death Song and has always been.
Yeah,
which is it's a really neat way of looking at things, but it's not anything you could technically confirm. So there's a lot of fun stuff with that.
When is the death song part of the soundtrack?
Taken King, track 13, Death Singer's Dirge.
There you go.
It's literally just wizards screaming for like a solid minute and a half. And maybe we'll understand why it's on the soundtrack one time, but it's actually a thing.
that's the other thing with this increase, especially, and I've not been holding a lot of weight around these some of these theories until I guess we had our discussion today, but there's this whole continuous recurring theme of frequency, song, tone, and despite all of that, mechanically, functionally in the game, we haven't had to engage with a lot of things that are, you know, we've had the turn off the Death Singer's song by, you know, getting the unweaving aura, right? Like making them sing opposite songs to weaken them and allow ourselves to live, right? Which makes sense. But we as Guardians.
Is this in King's Fall?
Yeah, that would be in King's Fall, right? Yeah. The two Death Singers, you have one is singing the song of unweaving.
You need opposite buffs in order to survive.
So, and that buff both protects you and removes power from the other singer, right? Because they heard the song that the other one was singing. And I imagine they're probably not supposed to hear those songs. Or if they do, there's not supposed to be guardians present. But the first place that we encounter tonality in the game is with the oracles. And sometimes I wonder if maybe we all missed something there. Because everyone's first fucking instinct in that raid was, this is Simon Says, right. I need to play the tones back. And but once we all figured out, oh, well, you just blow them up.
yeah,
you know, it. I have curiosities that maybe there is going to be a lot of stuff, and it's already happening in the lore that's referring back to experiences that we've had as guardians 5 years ago. Nacho is, of course, of the group of people who thinks that we super missed something.
Here's the thing as well, considering now that we got lore that indicates what No Time to Explain meant, and after the very big pointer towards Elsie Bray probably being the Exo Stranger, you know, after things like that, I'm very much always going to sit there and say we've definitely missed things. And not even by the nature of, like, hey, you know, we missed something because it wasn't necessarily told to us. It also just by the fact that, like, context, when you combine it, is really hard to find. Like, there's some really obvious pointers that you can get in Destiny's lore, but sometimes things don't feel like they should be connections until something else is created that points it out, you know?
Sure.
Like, there's a lot that comes along.
This does make me curious, though. What is your opinion on the folks that think, like, we never actually finished Vault of Glass? Because there's like a hidden puzzle. I was exposed to this, and, like, there is some seriously crazy shit out there that I've read by people like trying to deconstruct everything. I'm
content to say we're done in Vault. Let's leave it at that. You know? Like, our understanding of time and destiny is changing constantly because we get all this new stuff, which implies how it works, but isn't completely clear all the time. So I'm never going to be content to sit there and say that Vault of Glass is donezo. Mm. Like, even when it comes down to the way that you kill the final boss, like, there's ideas of how it works and there's competing theories of time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like, there's a lot of structured debate around it, which gets way over a lot of people's heads. The reality of it is, like, it's just really freaking hard to tell any of this as being true or untrue, because it's hard to display how time properly works, you know?
Yeah.
It's one of the biggest problems with saying Vault of Glass is complete. I mean, even after we finished the raid, we still went back in there, like, what, three times or so with various different adventures? Like, we definitely went back in there with Skolas and the House of Wolves. Praedith's mission was definitely a thing, and technically we would go back in there again because, you know, when you do the Praedith mission for No Time to Explain, it opens up a completely different section, you know? Like, there's a lot that goes on. And I, just by the nature of it being intertwined with timelines, I don't know if we'll ever truly be done. Also, fun fact, it's in the Whisper mission, because you can look through the portal and see it there too, so...
Right. Yeah, no, that's right. Yeah, and you do the oracles in that mission, don't you? Or is that the...
Yes.
Yeah, you do. Yes. The oracles came back. So I just... And then it really... I really wanted to talk about that because the whole... The fact that there's like 9 pages of lore talking about, you know, the experience of Praedith in the vault and what he's seeing and had seen, and the fact that we talked to him and his ghost and all of this other stuff in D1, and now it's coming back. It'd be really interesting. It would be really symmetrical, smile, if the journey ended where it began
with,
like,
orcs
5 years from now.
Sorry. I thought you were talking stream-wise. No,
the whole journey. With the vault. Yeah, the overall journey. It would be interesting. I wouldn't hate that. And that's something that I really have appreciated about the lore recently, is that despite explaining an incredible amount of stuff that we didn't have access to before, there's still so many possibilities layered throughout the universe that they're really just sort of giving us points of data that we can use to reanalyze some stuff that we already know, along with what we're learning. But yeah,
it makes me really content just to know, like, hey, the universe is bigger than this and you don't understand everything.
Yeah.
Like there was like a few years back, I would have been really irritated by that. And I would have said, God, just why can't you tell me all the truth? But, you know, like when you're telling an evolving story like this, I feel like that's undoubtedly of more value, that things can unfold in unforeseen ways. And beyond just all of that, you know, like I feel now the community at large and everyone else has started to appreciate the value of accepting when you're wrong.
Yeah.
You know, and saying like, hey, we made an assumption about this. This is a thing and it definitely shouldn't be like this. Like this is not how this particular function.
I'm wrong. Should work all in game. The time.
I am.
It's a great thing about this. The side of the lore community is like, they're very super passionate about certain things and sticklers for knowledge, but like, I can't not call them humble, you know, like they're all very wonderful guys and gals because they will sit there and if someone is wrong, like they'll go ahead and they'll like backtrack and be like, hey, you know, I was incorrect here. It's something I've learned from them because I fucking suck at doing that.
Yeah. I just get yelled at. No. That's not a tangent. I agree. I like that things are evolving forward and, you know, I love it. I love being wrong and changing my mind. It's like one of my favorite things. What is your take? And I think we might have talked about this before. But what is your take on the fact that like the Vex sing?
Oh yeah, because they have that listed in some of the in the Aspect book. They talk about how the goblin's song echoes through the garden, right?
Yeah.
So again, it makes a really interesting potential like sit down link between the light and the Vex again, I think.
Yeah.
Like that always talks about them as gardeners and everything. And it talks about the traveler not necessarily the traveler, probably more closely correct to say the light as being the gardener. Mm-hmm. And again, it goes back to Inquisition of the Damned and the fact that there was the Song of Creation or the Song of Life, rather.
Yeah.
Which, you know, predates the Death Song. I think that the fact that they sing is just another one of those really interesting things in Destiny. And if they are somehow related to the light, it proves kind of again that there's that symmetry, you know?
Like, yeah.
There is a Song of Life and a Song of Death and the Vex. And again, okay, crazy, dumb, spinfoily movie.
Yeah, we're way in the deep end of speculation and trying to understand things at this point. I hope everyone knows that.
So when Pujari jumps into the Black Garden, it's actually told to him that this is a place of life,
yeah.
You know, from this, like, it's basically a flower shaped like a ghost, but it looks like a rose and it has thorns on it, one of which cuts Pujari. Mm-hmm. You've basically got this crazy moment as well where it says, like, to a guardian, you are a dead thing. And then, of course, also, again, it talks about the gardeners of this place being in vessels of bronze, which is clearly a reference to the Vex, right?
Yeah.
When you look at all of those things and push it all together, it really starts to paint this kind of closeness between the Vex and the light. And I sit there and I wonder, because of the purpose of the Vex, as explained in Curse of Osiris, whether this was a rule, like whether the Vex might have been the rule that was created by the Traveler. Like, if you sit there and think about it, like, they are incredibly complex and they are kind of trying to fulfill an end state of the universe where they are necessary to it, where they are also ontological, where they are a part of the universe. Mm-hmm. But if you go beyond just that, you see that they do that through complexity and they're using sort of the mathematical calculations. And in a way, it's kind of saying like, hey, we're going to fix ourselves into this game and we're going to do it scientifically. We're going to prove that it's possible. It doesn't necessarily fit with like the stark calculations of the darkness as is sometimes done, but it does fit into this idea of the sword logic being simple and the bomb logic being more complex. Beyond all of just that, though, I think their purpose might, if I don't know if this is how it's going to pan out, but I feel like their purpose might have been twisted. You know, like the entirety of the time when the Vex are trying to make themselves a part of the final purpose of the universe, you see this kind of notion towards them being this force that is separate from light and dark.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that may have always have been the case. Like, it feels to me like they were something that was created as a means of like pushing. Oh, do you see this too?
No, what? No, I don't. I just had this thought.
There's a very floaty gulp.
Oh, okay. I just had a thought. What if the Vex are the Traveler's first failed experiment to making us from another timeline?
I mean, maybe. Take a look as well as what the Vex are, right? If you're looking for a way of disproving the sword logic, and you're looking for a way of saying the strong does not always survive, what are the Vex? They are really small. Individually, a Vex is tiny. Together, they make up a greater complexity. There is a way of saying that, you know, they could apply to sword logic, though, which is that even though they're small, they can be considered as simple, even though their larger whole does create something unbelievably complicated. So I'm not sure quite how you know, you could definitely twist that in either direction, but
yeah,
man, like, yeah, it,
I just think it's interesting is if, okay, so listen,
business time.
Listen,
I like it.
So if we're doing game theory and we're talking about two entities that have never truly interacted with each other at odds, their first attempts at doing anything are going to be flawed, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's the nature of playing a game. As you practice, you get better, right? So if the gardener was like, oh, I will just simply create something that takes care of wherever it's at or wherever it's around, or I will find a race across one of these infinite dimensions that is pliable or has the ability to move throughout the entirety of the game, every dimension, every timeline, every possibility, and I'll use them to sort of make sure that things continue growing, which would add sense to why these entirely mechanical with an organic tummy beings, when they are in complete control of areas that have the potential to be lush, they are incredibly lush, filled with life, filled with pretty much anything that isn't sentient, you know, whether that's, you know, birds and bees flying around, or the fact there's gigantic sprawling trees, and it's legitimately a garden, right?
Yeah.
So perhaps the Vex are this first expression of the Traveler's desire to take care of things. And maybe it's an incredible fucking misfire.
So something else. I can't believe I didn't think of this earlier. Okay, so Season of the Undying trailer. Yeah. It talks about the Black Garden, etc. It says, you know, we say the Vex were born in the Black Garden, but it was not the the next line, however, says the life in the garden called out a question. The Vex is the answer. I think people are too easily conflating that as being a note to saying the life in the Black Garden called out. What if the garden that Ikora is referring to in that sentence is actually the garden, like in the simulation, right?
Yeah.
Like, if it calls out and its question is, how do we create complex life that is capable of defying the consistently repeating pattern? And the Vex are the answer to that question. And then the garden, is the reason they exist as a result, you know, like, they exist as a means of trying to, like, square that circle. A little crazy and spinfoily and nonsensical. I'm sure somebody's going to pick that apart, especially considering there's, like, stuff which explicitly says Black Garden there instead of garden.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, there's...
that second sentence is definitely garden, not Black Garden.
It is... I mean, it's a little spinfoily, but ultimately... Yeah,
it's crazy.
You're talking... ultimately, you're talking about... you're talking about words that are being used repetitively over and over again. And, you know, there absolutely has to be a reason why, in my mind, there has to be a reason why the darkness used the flower game analogy, used the term gardener, used the term garden And the Garden of Salvation and all of the other times that people seem to talk about this caretaking behavior, right? Across the universe, this caretaking behavior is an expression of the light. So I mean, lore wise, from what's there, you might be right. But I also think that when you look at, you know, the intent of the author, aka the person designing the story, there has to be reasons that characters are using, you know, the same terminology over and over and over again, even when they're unrelated. And that could simply be the darkness trying to deceive us by using the words that we're used to hearing, or it could be part of a larger whole to teach us how to understand the universe. So that is going outside of the text a little bit, examining the person who wrote the lores, or the team that wrote the lores, intent. Where are they leading the story? Where are we going? But there's framework there for it, which goes back to why I said it's just so incredible that we're getting so much more information, and yet along with this information come exciting new opportunities for where they might want to take the story.
Indeed. So I guess the conclusion of this is you are no longer on Team Oryx is Dead.
Yeah. I mean, if we want to go back to that, I think that there is a possibility that he could come back, but also perhaps we kill that possibility in the dungeon or sometime soon before we fight Savathun.
I think I'm with you on that one, man. Like, I think that Oryx is, because this is the thing, right? The Hidden Swarm are the ones that are trying to bring him back, presumably. And the Hidden Swarm's fortress is the Scarlet Keep now. And dungeon takes place below the Scarlet Keep.
Yeah.
So you're literally descending not just into that area that is a fortress of the Hidden Swarm, but also into their pit, where they decide who their champions are, probably, and also down into their most secure location, which inevitably is probably where they're holding a ceremony so that they can resurrect one of the most powerful hive that's ever existed. You know, like, I find it really hard to not believe that at this point. And also it makes a lot of sense as to why it was in the hive cryptoglyph, why it was part of the ARG, what they're hinting to with this, like, this surely has got to be a thing, you know? Like,
yeah.
I can't sit there and not think that we're not going to see some kind of hint to this at very least, you know?
Yeah, it would be a little weird to have all this lead up, especially since the cryptoglyph directly references this stuff.
Either that or it's a Touch of Malice secret mission that we somehow start. I don't know. Like, it's got to be one of these, you know? Like, oh, yeah, there's exciting possibilities.
I am the thing that I learned from all that is I am very concerned that we have not recaptured the Touch of Malice. Like, the fact that we don't have the gun is what's really concerning to me, because the Ravenous Heart is in there. And if the Hive have that, then they can.
Oryx could quite feasibly come back.
Exactly. Like, if they have that, there's almost certainly a ritual they could discover to bring Oryx back, even against his own will. Because I'm sure that, you know, Hive magic sure seems to not give a fuck.
I mean, you know, we're talking about Oryx. This is a guy that literally made a ship that was his throne world that was a paradox that he just twisted inside out because he said, screw the world and screw the universe. And I don't need to. These are your rules, not mine.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I don't work with these. That's all up to you, bud. Like, none of this matters for me.
Man. If Oryx survived true death in the throne world, therefore not able to be brought back as a nightmare, shouldn't that also apply to Crota? There's a lot of people that are stating that, or concerned or curious. And if you have to go, feel free to let me know.
It's all good. I'm here for this.
Okay. There are people that are concerned that the fact that there isn't a nightmare of Oryx floating around somewhere.
See, that's what's interesting, because in part 5 of the cryptoglyphs lore stuff, it actually talks about how he lives on as a scar in the mind of Eris Morn,
yes,
as a wound in her mind, which, what are nightmares? They are the manifestations of Guardian's past trauma, Oryx mm-hmm. undoubtedly being a trauma for Eris. Beyond just that, it talks about how she therefore is ultimately the representation of him, and in the process of being his ultimate enemy, has kind of embodied him and has proven his existence to be true. And also then states, what has she found? What has she found, in reference to what she's discovered on the moon? Which is undoubtedly talking about the pyramid ships. And Oryx, of course, is trying to follow the darkness and is trying to become one with death. I think that the likelihood is, if there is a nightmare of Oryx and we can't destroy it, it could become the real version of Oryx, effectively. Mm. Because it goes on with his will and his need to survive, you know? And that might be enough to then, in Hive ritual terms, summon him back. Whether that ends up being true or not is all spinfoil and theory, but like, ooh, there's big implications, dude. Like, it's exciting.
Well, what I liked about that lore piece in particular is there's a statement that says she acts on my will unbeknownst to her. So her behavior, although, I mean, I fully believe that Eris is well-intentioned, but her behavior, even when well-intentioned, is being forged by his will. Like, that's the insistent statement inside of the lore. So, like, I think that's really interesting. I also think that it's super interesting that, and we haven't even talked about this, and I don't know how we haven't, that the pyramid, that the darkness was here all along.
Yes, it's been here since literally the Golden Age.
The beginning.
Frickin' revelation. Yeah, it's like, been there all along.
Look, we thought that the darkness was so far away, and that the darkness, you know, was coming, right? It sensed the Traveler's Light and was coming.
Taking a nap.
Here. It was just
present.
It was just either like influencing, manipulating, or observing from behind the scene. But the darkness has watched us kill Atheon, kill Crota, and the darkness may have even inspired Crota to massacre all the Guardians on the moon. Like, I mean,
or made it a little simpler, perhaps, something. But it's definitely been there. It's definitely had an influence on the story. Like, the fact that we find it underneath Luna has so many implications for the wider story. It's nuts.
just watching, just hanging out, biding its time before it wants to talk to us. And it's very interesting when you look at the scope of the entire story that it picks this moment in time to speak to us.
Mm-hmm.
Obvious and reveal itself via Eris, and, you know, which again, like trying to bring in a sympathetic author to, you know, trick us into believing whatever the fuck's going on. And Eris is a perfect sleeper agent if she's just unknowingly reacting to whatever is going on. It's really scary.
So, so something also about that, like, we go into the pyramid initially to try and find some kind of leverage so we can defeat the darkness, right?
Yeah.
Like, that's our intention. But when we leave, it's really clear this has been a trap and the darkness wanted us to arrive all along. Like, the first words that our ghost says when you land in the pyramid are, "Welcome, we've been waiting."
Yeah.
And it's like, this is a trap. And then when we go into the Garden of Salvation raid, you know, the first thing that Eris says is, "They take us for fools," you know? And it's basically going into this notion and saying again, like, they're trying to play us, you know? We may be playing into their hands by doing all of this.
Yeah.
Like, we need to be more careful. So, like, the idea of Eris being an unwitting sleeper agent totally seems much, much more plausible just when you look at that from a base standpoint of what could the darkness be capable of and what's happened over time. Like, holy Lord. Oh,
yeah.
Can you imagine?
When I realized like how important the timeline was, the fact that the ship had just always been there, I was like, this is fucked up. Like, the whole everything that we believed about where the darkness was and like, oh, well, we're just talking, we're experiencing interactions with agents of the darkness.
It'll come in Destiny 3, it's fine.
Yeah, and then
time to prepare.
Been there all along.
you round the corner in Shadowkeep, and all of a sudden, everyone has brown pants. And it's this escalated quickly.
Are we just feeding the darkness by following Eris? See, and that's the, and this is what Bive and I talked about when we were talking about the lore and setting this up, is that the consistent theme of the Guardian's actions are, no matter what we do, we seem to further corrupt the things around us. So, you know, we... we went to go kill Riven, and
then we unleashed the curse.
And we made the Death Battery. We did it. Our action did it.
Worth noting. Falseness on the idea of Death Battery.
Oh, Death Battery is not real.
Death Battery might be a thing, might not be a thing,
or might not be a thing.
We don't know what Savathun's actual plans are, and we don't know what Savathun's power is being actually said. So yeah, that's worth noting. Like,
if there's a Death Battery,
we did unleash it. So yeah, that we definitely did. That's the moral evil that we've unleashed by trying to make the world a better place. You know? Yeah.
So we curse everything. You know, and then if this thing with Oryx is true, by killing Oryx, we helped initiate his plan. What I am curious is, I would like to know the mistake we are making with the Vex. Does that make sense?
No, I feel you. I understand.
You know, if the mistake we made with Oryx was killing him, and yet his will still influences Eris and is leading us to the darkness, and if the error that we made with Riven was we killed Riven and created a perpetual curse on the Dreaming City, you know, the errors in those situations are really obvious. What are we screwing up with the Vex? Because arguably screwing that up is the biggest potential mistake.
Because the minute you start messing with time, you're in big trouble.
Yeah.
On that note, two things. First of all, when they had Season of Dawn up in the Vidoc on the discussion board, the first note that they state underneath that is fix the timeline. So, yeah, that's a thing in the Vidoc.
Okay.
Secondly, I want to go out and just say it. Our big mistake is not really ours. It's more Ikora's building the damn portal in the tower.
Yeah, we need to talk about the portal in the tower. I think that's a big mistake.
I think it's a huge mistake to put it there, but like put it on Mercury or something where it can actually just, if it's lost, it's not a big deal because it's already part of a huge piece of Vex architecture.
Yeah.
But like, dude, holy lord, building a portal to timelines is not just a really bad idea, but also it has so many different implications for what it could do to the story, right? Like, I don't want to spoil things, but if you looked into spoilery stuff with the IMDb for voice actors in Shadowkeep, there are some interesting roles in there that I won't discuss because spoilers. And yeah, the implications for that are huge. And I don't know if you know what I'm talking about.
Ben, I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm gonna DM this to you, and you are gonna lose your mind.
Yeah, Vive wants to get advice, trying to make a reaction video right now. It's fine.
Yeah. It's in your Discord DMs.
Okay.
Point being, you can kind of see where the depth of things go from just that one name. And I don't want to discuss it in video because spoilers.
Okay.
But yeah.
You DM'd it to me over here. Shut up!
Yes.
Shut the fuck up!
Yes.
I fucking knew it. Already, I knew it. Knew it. Yeah. Okay.
That reaction will tell you guys all you need to know. Point being, there are huge potential implications of building a portal in the middle of the tower which connects to alternate timelines and then
show us, helps chat.
Go to the Undying Mat.
It is something that many of you have already said. And we'll discuss it again at some point in the future when it's not contextualized by this as a spoiler, so you don't know it is a spoiler. That's how I'll approach this.
Indeed. Beyond just that, I know that if I actually like openly discuss that on my YouTube, people would be mad.
Super mad. Yeah, and I get that.
I'm not going to say more than that. You know,
Chad. It was by stick pick. That was what it was. Very impressive.
It was.
Absolutely. I wasn't expecting to back me up. I was not expecting that. Yeah.
Well, you don't like it. I mean, I'll grant you, it's not the prettiest, but like a bad bitch.
Oh my god.
I'm paralyzed. I'm crying. Jesus Christ. Okay.
This went off the rails, man. Oh,
a little goodness. Bit off the rails. My so my theory
people didn't need to know.
Have you seen my theory about have you seen my theory about what I think is going to happen to Akora?
No.
I think she's going to sacrifice herself to shut the gate.
Oh, fuck. And then it's just going to be Zavala left over?
I think she's going to have to go inside and close it from there and hold it shut. So she might not die, but she will effectively not exist to us anymore.
Dude. Oh my god.
Because she's shown the ability to manipulate Vex portals and open them with effort. So holding one shut wouldn't be
out of the question.
That hard. And I do realize that the portal goes to an infinite number of probable realities, but there might be a staging zone directly on the other side of the portal. We have no idea how time works. So that's like, it's to me, it's a possibility. And I know that would make a lot of people super angry. But yeah, I don't know. Or maybe Osiris does it. Who fucking knows?
Mm-hmm. I haven't heard from Big Boy O in quite some time, dude.
I just know that the portal's a huge mistake. Somebody's probably going to pay for it. And I know that there's conversations about them testing it. But as you've seen by all of the lore that we read, nobody really understands how time works with the Vex. Like, we have approximations and we have blunt instruments that we've hit it with, and it's, you know, it's
done things.
Yeah, and like we've
been able to sort of understand some things, kind of maybe-ish,
Yeah.
It's hard to draw any conclusive things from it, man.
Yeah. So maybe that'll never happen. But if we're talking about the disaster of the gate, she also is like that kind of a character, right? Like, I did this. Like, you know, like I have to
when it comes to Io, she's very much like, she's in that kind of existential moment where it's like, what am I without my light? And then her immediate response, Ikora's, is not a flight or fright thing, it's a fight thing.
Yeah,
she will take both the bull's horns and she will try and flip that thing on its hinds, like, you know, like it's very much her instinct to fight. So yeah, man, I feel you.
Or I'm full of crap and I'm just trying to make you sad, like T-Rex is pointing out. So that's super interesting. What do you think about the new insights? They're kind of scattered all over the place. Before I open my mouth, let me make sure I'm did you have any other like takeaways from Praydeath's experience of being like trapped in the vault and seeing all of the simulated realities or maybe actual realities? Like,
I have the crazy spin foily theory that I briefly spoke about on Twitter, but I don't think anybody quite got.
Let's hear it. I'm super intrigued.
Okay, so go to one of Destiny's landing zones in one of the patrolable areas, somewhere like, say, the EDZ is probably a good example because it drops you in a relatively uncontested zone.
Sure. Right?
If you go there, you will be able to sit down and you will be able to find radios. And occasionally those radios will spit out little bits of like chatter and garbage between NPCs, right? So it'll be like, you know, in the EDZ, Devrim K is going to be talking to Hawthorne. He's going to be like, don't move that group of refugees. There's a fallen patrol coming through. Just hold it back for another 30 minutes or so. So that, stuff like that. If you sit and listen for long enough, you get a really wispy voice that says the following. I am the door. I open unto the void. One day the masters will step through and then you will know. And it's said in a voice that's feminine and there's not much else to discern about it than that. Previously, I thought this was a big hint towards the Nine. Now, after reading Aspect, I'm not so sure. Because here's the thing, if you go to Aspect and actually look it up,
we're going to do this. Praydeath's radio is part of that.
Praydeath's radio is, he has a radio, but the final words of the lore book indicate something which is terrifying, you know? Like, it talks about how everybody's preparing for their plans, you know, like 160 Mayas reaching for Choimers by their side, 158 Choimers reach back, one Praedith waiting for the conductor's baton to drop, uncountable Vex in the garden waiting for the same event, a synchrony none of them notice. Somewhere a veil is always lifting, somewhere Kabir is always dooming himself, somewhere a door is always opening, somewhere they are always stepping through. So if you relate that back to what you hear on the radios, I am the door I open onto the void. One day the masters will step through, and then you will know. What does that even mean? But the two could very well be related, because it's so similar that it's either got to be one of Bungie's very deliberate red herrings, or there could be a link there which states, hey, this is actually some kind of communication that is implying again that someone is stepping through and someone is reaching forward into our reality. And I think that might link further towards the darkness, because there's a whole bunch of stuff about how the darkness is supposed to be formless in some sense.
Aliens.
You know, there's formlessness and form whenever you take a comparison to the deep in the sky, whenever you look in the Books of Sorrow. Like, it fascinates me just to think about what that transmission might mean. And it's one of the weirdest, strange side little bits of lore that exists. And I genuinely still to this day wonder what the hell it's supposed to mean.
Super tucked away. Has that been in the game since like launch?
It's been in the game since launch, to the best of my knowledge.
Motherfucker.
I know. And like, it's the last sentence of this lore book, which makes me think like it's got to be somewhat significant. And beyond just that, like, it's such a tidied away, tiny reference. The radio itself being used in Praedith's instance of the Vault of Glass
already heavily weights it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's what makes me believe it might be something to do that. But beyond just that, the pulses that Praedith uses to send messages out from the vault, there's like a very heavy implication, if I'm not wrong, that they are like the direct result of the darkness. So a mysterious voice talking about how they are the door and they open onto the void and that one day the masters will step through. Like, what are we implying there? Who are you and who are your masters? You know, like, are we talking something to do with darkness here? Like, is this potentially, again, you know, it sounds almost like the emissary's voice. So I thought at first it was talking about the Nine, you know, and talking about how they open onto the void and potentially they are a part of it. And that sort of does make some sense considering that they're dark matter, but this could either be the most wonderful red herring that Bungie's placed in a very long time, or it's something that points to a really cool potential idea that they've kind of been hinting towards this from the very beginning.
That's fucking,
like, I don't know, but isn't that crazy that exists? Like, isn't that wonderful?
Oh, yeah. I mean, and I wouldn't put it past. I mean, that's the thing, is like, we're all learning the story as they choose to unveil it. My sincerest hope is that it is all written so they can do things 2 years in advance because they know where things are going to go. And we're seeing, we're seeing continuous references to, we're seeing more and more references popping up to the events of the first couple of years in Destiny's universe. And it would be really surprising to me if we weren't to go through a journey of, you know, divining how our initial actions affected the universe around us.
Like, our very first real final boss was to kill the heart of the Black Garden, which it seems pretty clear is the closest we've ever gotten to facing the real darkness.
Yes.
The second final boss that we face technically in Taken King is Oryx, you know, is one of the most powerful Hive, probably the most powerful at that time, you know? Like, we create these huge consequences and huge circumstances for the universe within those first few years. And I think you're totally right. Like, all of the consequences of those actions, all that fallout is really what we deal with. Like, Forsaken is really just like a final chapter of what happens from Dark Below. Because when we kill Crota, we then summon Oryx. And when we summon Oryx, you know, Mara has to go and fight him. He takes Riven. Like, there, all of this stuff leads together, and it's all about those opening few acts and our, honestly, kind of miraculous actions in those few opening moments, you know?
Yeah, like, the overcoming of, it's, I mean, it's insane.
With seemingly absolute power.
Yeah, I mean, like, to the Vex, there's no way that like, you fight Atheon, you have any idea how much shit he's probably just been like, all right, well, you're annoying. All right, no, now you're 500,000 years away. So I guess you don't exist. We did that and came back and fucking killed him. Like, yeah. That's intense. Like the amount of time scale that goes on in just that one fight spans like the beginning, middle, and end of a planet's life cycle.
Right.
Like, you know, and you capture that energy to create your own fate, you know, and that can't go without consequences. Like, it just can't. Yeah. Like, you don't fight time without ripples. And we certainly, since we don't have the backing of an entity, right? Like, we have the backing of the Traveler, which is why we can come back to life. But it hasn't give us a mission statement. Like, it doesn't sit there and tell us what the fuck we're supposed to do. We just are fighting for survival.
Yeah, it's not sitting there up at night crying because a football player that was under your company's wing, you know, got hurt and the contract's in danger, and then you write a mission statement and then you get fired the next day. Like, this isn't an old movie with Tom Cruise in it. Like, I'm desperately trying to remember what the name of that was. Oh God, I can't. Honestly, man, you'd think I'd remember considering it's got Show Me the Money in it.
Oh, you know, you're talking about Jerry Maguire?
There we go. Maybe. I can't remember for the life of me. I feel like it must be. Yeah. Maybe. Oh God, I can't remember.
Maybe the Traveler doesn't care what we do as long as we live. It's possible. Atheon's literally time's conflux. We killed the conjunction point of a lot of different time. That shit's affecting something somewhere. Yeah. Clearly he's talking about Cocktail. Yeah.
Something else as well. Wow, words. I had a train of thought and I've kind of lost it. Okay. So with regards to the Traveler being kind of ignorant, potentially, and maybe not caring, have you read the Mark 44 status sides recently?
Not recently.
Because they have a lore tab that will fascinate you on that note. The lore tab for the status sides, it doesn't look like it's something that should be attached to them, right? Because it's like, you know, they are Mark 44 standicides, but it talks as though it's another one of the darkness's entries, you know? Mm. It talks about the gardener and it talks about what it's doing and it talks about how it is ignorant and can't hear our suffering, you know?
That's interesting. Well, the standicides seem to be crafted from the same material that the Ruin Wings are.
Indeed. And something else. What's in Ruin Wings' description, right?
Yeah. The silver tree.
In the garden grows a tree with silver wings. The leaves are ruined. The bark is disaster. Of the seeds, we do not speak. And it's just like all of those things come back together because it actually mentions that tree of silver wings in the garden in the unveiling lore book.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm wondering whether that's connected to this stuff too, right?
Like, wouldn't it be crazy if the Ruin Wings and the standicides are both like really, really old
dark armor or
dark pieces of armor? Yeah, like maybe there was a deeper interaction with the darkness before the collapse and we started developing technology based off of its whatever, you know, materials, right? Mm-hmm. Which is why, like, any piece of gear that looks like that seems to contain a lament or a statement about the darkness or a level of frustration about, like, well, you know, or the darkness talking to us, because maybe we led to the collapse. Like, maybe we fucked it up because they tried to commune with the darkness and that shit went real bad.
Mm-hmm.
Nesarek Sin has something similar. Yeah.
Mm, it kind of has something similar. Talks a lot about so Nesarek Sin is one of those really interesting ones because I don't know if I can conflate it with darkness. It talks a lot.
That's just the one about the. Is Nesarek Sin the one about the death astronauts?
No, I don't believe so.
Okay,
so Nesarek Sin. Here we go. Yeah, so this talks about of hated. It's a passage from Of Hated Nesarek, which is a pre-Golden Age text, right? Okay. And it talks about he is the final god of pain, the purest light, the darkest hour. He shall rise again. When the guiding shine fades and all seems lost, he will call to you. Fear not, all he offers is not as dark as it may seem. For Nisarek is no demon, but a fiend, arch and vile in ways unknown. He is a path and a way, one of many. And his sin, so wicked, so divine, is that he will never cower when dusk does fall, but stand vigilant as old stars die and new light blinks its first upon this fated eternity. So the interesting thing there is it talks about Nisarek almost being something which stands against darkness at the end, right?
Yeah.
Like, it talks about how he is indeed a demon, arch and vile. That doesn't necessarily mean that it needs to be combined with the darkness. And also, the darkness, if you're to believe the words that it's put forward, is not a being. Again, this very much is based on believing both in the sword logic as the Hive dictates it and also in what the darkness has told us about itself. It's very much one of these entities that gives you this sense that it's actually something that doesn't value pain. It values strong life. And instead of seeing individuals suffer and see pain, in most instances, it will kill them. There are some points at which it tries to assert its dominance. And in those instances, yeah, there's definitely implied agony there. But it's not something where the process of the sword logic is meant to be particularly vindictive. It's just meant to be brutal, you know? Whereas when you look at Nisarek, it speaks very specifically about pain. It speaks very specifically about the cause of all this. And it also says that it will stand against that final dusk, which to me at least implies that it kind of, it's a little bit like Nyarlathotep, which I think is the, have you, I don't know how much of the Cthulhu mythos you've read.
Not a huge pile of it.
Okay, so Nyarlathotep is a deity that is basically capable of shape-shifting, and their entire shtick is just, I'm going to cause suffering for humanity because this entertains me.
Yes, you know? Yeah, okay, and I'm familiar with that. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so the thing is, they don't want the world to stop existing, and they don't want humanity to, and they could very easily destroy humanity with all their power, but they don't want to, because otherwise they'd get bored, you know? They would no longer have any subjects to torture, effectively.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like, it's a very similar concept to Nisarek here, you know? Like, you've got a being that would stand against the dusk as new stars blink their first upon this fated eternity, because it doesn't want the universe to end. It doesn't want the end of time. It doesn't want things to die. It wants them to live so they can suffer. So it's a very, it's very different from the idea of what the darkness is at the end of the day. Like, yes, definitely evil.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not the same as darkness, I would presume.
Kind of reminds me of what's that guy in Elder Scrolls? The Daedric god that is always fucking with you. In ESO, he turns into like a cat and you have a fucking fever dream. What's his name? Yeah, Sheogorath.
Sheogorath.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Sheogorath. It sounds a lot like that. Like, it's like I'm evil and I'm going to make you do awful evil things, but like, you need to be here for me to do evil things to you. So, you know, I'll make sure that you stay alive.
Yeah.
Similar. That's crazy. Dude,
isn't that amazing though? Like, the fact that there's that potential link. Also, I don't know about you, but I'm a huge fan of anything to do with old gods. So it's just like, yes, inject this into my veins. Like, do it.
shoot that right in there.
Yeah, give me some good stuff.
Yeah, I mean, well, there's so much, you know, so much referencing in Destiny's lore out to like concepts from whether it's like religions or philosophies, like, you know, like the final shape is Plato, like the thing that must exist, the tautological reality of like, hey, check it out, guys, this is what a perfect triangle is, you know, and then you
take a look at sword logic and it's and contrast it with bomb logic and you're basically contrasting what is effectively social Darwinism with what I think most people would call reasonable society, where we all try and coexist, you know, like an extreme form of social Darwinism, which says the strongest alone are worthy of survival. Everything else needs to be eradicated. And that's just the way the universe will be set right. You know, that's literally space Nazis, you know,
it's space Nazis. You're right.
Yeah. You know, like the Hive are just big ass space Nazis.
Fucking assholes. I never thought about it like that.
But no, see, like all of it kind of reaches back into that social dynamic, you know, like you can conflate all these and say like, hey, you know, on the grand scheme of the universe, like what does this philosophy give us? And for the darkness, like in the cosmic sense, there is a certain way in which you can sit there and at least see that how that perspective exists, right?
Yeah.
Like, I find it really hard for someone to morally be able to square that. But by that same token, for someone to understand where the logic comes from, I think is not just important, but also is necessary to understand how you can sort of, like, work against it and state, like, actually, I don't think this is how the universe is supposed to work, you know? Like, you need an understanding of both in order to see which perspective you agree with, you know? Exactly. To be clear, I also want to go ahead and state as well, like, this is all based on what the darkness has told us of its understandings. Yeah. So the reality of it is that we still don't know everything. Like, yeah, it could be that we're missing a vital piece of the puzzle. So I wouldn't jump to any judgments so quickly when it comes to, like, the darkness and what it instantly means.
Well, also, yeah, I mean, and we still have...
If your friend likes the darkness, don't call him a Nazi. That's probably about it.
No, please don't.
It's
not quite the same.
It's very different. No, it's very
but, different. But, I mean, to that point, we've received zero direct communication from the Traveler.
Right.
Sans the speaker.
Missions, and that was about it.
Sans the speaker, who you know, we still... Well, is a corruptible figure. I actually don't know a lot. Like, I don't know if there's been anything new discovered about the speaker lately.
So, I mean, at the end of the campaign for D2, there was the whole thing of, I don't speak to the Traveler.
Right,
Traveler doesn't speak to me, right?
Yeah.
But here's another thing as well. We did actually get some, it's not a direct form of communication, but we got some kind of communication, which is the visions that you and Ikora get at the beginning of Forsaken, which lead you to Io, where you find your new subclass for the first time.
Right. Very correct. Yeah.
So there's been some kind of communication, but it's not exactly been direct. It's been very, how do I put it?
That's a vision.
It's a vision, but it's also one of these things where it's like, you do see the light suddenly becoming a thing, and, you know, there are great beacons of empowerment all of a sudden. So there's probably some kind of intervention of the light somehow, but all of the dialogue that you get is through a really mysterious voice. It's not direct, and it's not going in with an agenda, which maybe is a virtue considering everything we've said about the darkness, but it's really hard to say that that was the light directly, you know?
Yeah, I mean, what I'm trying to say, if people are misunderstanding me in chat, is like, we have not received a direct, obvious explanation directly from the light via allegory or anything else about what it is and what it wants us to do, or if it wants us to do anything. Which I find concerning, because going back to our discussion about, you know, we as guardians and even as observers in this story don't know if the entire thing is a construct of someone else for us. You know, we believe what we're told from everyone. And so the fact that we don't have a direct communication from the light via an emissary that we're aware of is concerning to me at this point, because we're still left guessing at it. And I think, like, that opens up a doorway for the, like, I feel now that I need the light to tell me what it wants, what it is, how it works.
Right. Instead of one side of the story, it only feels right to know the other.
Yeah.
You know?
I want to know why it thinks the way it thinks. Because we know why the darkness thinks the way it thinks now from its own mouth. But currently the best guess that we have is, you know, the Traveler is the embracement of complexity, which is, I mean, like, even down to their shapes. That has always been the duality of everything. Is the triangle is the most complex shape you can make, and a sphere is the, or triangle is the simplest shape you can make, and a sphere is the most complex shape that you can make, and mathematically.
And even if you take it with the other side and, like, compare even the idea of swords and bombs, again, it goes back to the idea of simplicity and complexity, right?
Yeah.
Like, four sides to a four-sided pyramid and a tetrahedron like that. Define simple in a more simple term than that, and I will give you a medal, because, you literally cannot make a three-dimensional shape with three sides. It's got to be four, bare minimum. Yeah. Which is, you're completely correct.
So it's... So the battle of, you know, complexity versus simplicity is kind of the, like, inherent struggle,
or at least that's the ideological struggle that we're placed in. And because we have one side of that now directly advocating for itself, and winning people over, like there, like it's really
there are now people who are like, yeah, the dogmas is right.
Yeah, there, it is a very, it's a very powerful argument. And if you're someone that believes in order and in strength and in, I guess ultimate justice, if you're a, you know, if you're in the line of philosophy of Plato, you probably agree with the darkness and what it has to say a lot. I want to hear the light argue its case. Like, we've done it pretty well while we're talking, the idea of the value of complexity and like the David and Goliath analogy. But until we hear directly from the traveler exactly like what its thought process is, it could be something real shitty too.
Yeah,
like maybe right. The traveler is a petulant asshole.
And it leads us back to that potential thing with the Babylon 5 stuff, you know, like maybe the end result of Destiny's story is literally just us being like, we don't need either of you. Go away. Stop. Take your wars out of here. Like, we're just going to exist and we're going to be happy here. Thank you.
Yeah. Maybe the Guardians should just make their own fate.
Ooh, did you get goosebumps, chat? Did you get goosebumps, chat?
Oh my God.
What if we did the thing? What if killing? What if killing Atheon trapped us in a Vex simulation and we're trying to get out?
Oh boy. That scares me with complexity.
Nah, that's garbage. That won't happen. But yeah. Crap.
God dang.
Yeah,
I'm so happy we decided to do this.
Yeah, it's pretty great. Like there's a lot of potential realities. So is this lost? That's what a lot of people said when the Gardner analogy came up and the light and dark. Like, oh, is this lost? And I was like, I mean, it's every fundamental, you know,
conflict in the universe,
conflict, right? light and darkness allegory is just it's how we communicate with each other as humans. I don't necessarily think it's like gonna end up being that simple. I really do think that in the end we won't need either of them, and that we'll have to figure out a way to get rid of them.
Ben, I'm gonna fucking send you something to do with Babylon 5 because my language, but seriously,
no, you don't need it. I said fuck 100 times. what I fundamentally believe is this, is that inside of the story that the darkness tells us, it insists that it must exist, and it insists that its counterpart must exist, that they are, I'm going to quote it, cause I want to get it 100% right.
It's in the hang on.
Yeah, it's an unveiling.
Once upon a time, a gardener and a winnower lived together in a garden, and then there's a ton of asterisks.
Yeah, the asterisks.
It was once before a time, because time had not yet begun. We did not live, we existed as principles of ontological dynamics that emerged from mathematical structures as bodiless and inevitable as the primes. And thirdly, it was a field of possibilities that prefigured existence.
So
they had to be.
The second statement. Oh yeah, Daddy. The second statement is where I have a lot of issue. The second asterisk, okay. And this is from me doing like work on texts when I was in college. There is a fallacy in the statement. We existed as principles of ontological dynamics would simply state that I must be. But the fact that they use the verb emerged indicates that there was a point of creation, and they even say where they come from.
Mm-hmm.
In my mind, in describing itself, the darkness accidentally told us that it was created. Which means it's a being, which makes sense because it has sentience. But that also means that its insistence that it's a necessity is not necessary.
Yeah. Because it wasn't contingent for creation in the first place. It wasn't contingent for any of that.
Creation wasn't so contingent upon either of these entities. So
right?
While they may be beings beyond our comprehension, the necessity of their existence might be overstated, and that could be the lie. That they both must exist. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be fucked up if they were just working together to fuck
if they were just conning everyone in the whole universe?
Yeah.
Right? Like, what if this entire thing is just the great game, and at the end of the day, it's like, hey, we've got to destroy both of these things.
Shoot it first and then think about it later. Exactly. I mean, that's what we've done. That's what we did with Riven. Like, thinking back on that whole experience, we're really fucking dumb. Like, we know...
We do stupid shit all the time.
We know, dude. Like, all about how these fucking Ahamkara work, about how you can make wishes on accident, how you can... they're like evil genies that always give you the
tell for a wish is that their eyes are shimmering, and what happens in the raid when you indicate which eyes for the other side to shoot? They shimmer, they glow.
Yeah. Like,
we were given a ton of hints as to what was happening.
We were wishing the entire raid.
Like, and we fell right into that trap like a bee into treacle, dude. Like,
yeah.
Ugh. We've not been smart. Like, Guardians, just generally speaking, have been very sort of ask questions later. Shoot yesterday, really.
Yeah. Like, I still, like, after when we started reading, I was like, yeah, we fucking killed it out, huh, Carl? We're so smart. I love that we did that. And then,
Riven talks to you and says, finally,
yeah,
I never leave.
Yeah, and like, I was like, oh no.
Oh dear.
And then you remember all the other lore and you're like, shit. Like, I just made a bunch of problems.
Ah.
Yeah.
I also love that the first assumption when you do the Shadow Throne for the first time, Shirochi is standing outside and she says, come back victorious and we will call you Cursebreaker. Nope. Curse is still there.
Yeah.
Still a thing. Still very much here. Still happening.
What if the only thing that must exist is a combination of both, and we are the agents that keep that order, but both of the other forces are corrupted? I mean, the other takeaway from the parable is if we're to believe the author bias, clearly we know the darkness did something wrong. It found a knife and decided to start fucking up whatever the game it existed in was. We don't know that yet, but that's the assumption. And while we maybe don't know what the light did exactly, like, I don't think it's a petulant child.
It was like it murdered everyone's children quite.
There, yeah,
like,
there may or may not be some truth in that, in its discontentment with the game. Indeed. So we don't know. Like, it might not have snapped a universe out of existence with a towel. But maybe the light really is angry at how simple everything is and how, you know, nothing seems to get to live.
Nothing ever changes. It's one boring pun. Yeah.
Yeah. Like that could be the truth inside of that. So we might be leading to an end where our goal is to just free ourselves and then do whatever we want. Which would be awesome.
Again, it kills me so much every time we talk about this that you haven't seen Babylon 5.
I know. Now I'm going to start seeing Babylon 5. I'm going to start watching it now because now I have to.
I'll say this as well, like, total separate tangent on its own. Phenomenal television. Like, it's just a really brilliantly paced drama.
Yeah, it's been recommended to me a lot.
It's the very campy, like, 80s sci-fi / 90s sci-fi that you expect. But let me tell you, they do a brilliant job of telling a very big story.
Yeah.
Like, there's stuff that happens in season one that only gets explained until season three, and it all makes sense in the end, and it's part of a very well intertwined plot. Like, it's really freaking cool. Anyway, tangent aside, all of this kind of links me back to this idea of symmetry. And I feel like that's where I end up landing most of the time, is with Ulan Tan and his ideas with the symmetrist faction generally, that yes, you do need to have one, and both of them, you can't have one without the other. Both of them do need to exist as fundamental principles of the universe. But by that same token, when you look at the light and dark, you know, even as one advances, the other must advance. there is a point at which you can eventually reduce those symmetries to nothing, right? Because zero is also symmetrical to zero, if you kind of get what I mean.
No, I know exactly what you're talking about.
So it makes me wonder if there is a way of existing in a universe where neither of those principles are allowed to be. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, exactly. And yeah, I don't know. I just, that's the big takeaway for me from the lore with the darkness is that I don't know if the insistence of them is true.
As per usual, I think the best thing we can all do is just stay with that open mind. Because, like, how many times have we jumped into things as, like, a community and made an assumption?
Sure.
Like, and then run with it to its craziest logical extreme, which almost certainly is not true. You know, like,
yeah.
I think we are much better as a community at being open-minded with stuff. And I think that's the one thing everyone needs to know. Like, hold to your ideas, but remember that they are ideas. They are not fact, you know? Like, the number one lesson that I feel like we should all adhere to at this moment in time. Because, you know, like, if this does end up being the case that there's no objective truth, then, you know, like, it's all moot point anyway. Like, you might as well just keep going and just, hey, people who enjoy the darkness, enjoy the darkness, and people who enjoy the light, you know, light mode Twitter, dark mode Twitter, it's fine. Both can exist. Light mode Twitter, by the way, haha. Anyway, yeah, point being.
I like light mode too, big fan.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Someone else who is fine despises the dark gives you like moodiness. Anyway, yeah, point being, having both existing at the same time, and having both of those opinion points, it may just come down to it being simply that, you know, like there might not be a single truth to the universe and it might simply be that all of this stuff can coexist.
Yeah.
I'd keep a very open mind to any kind of answer that gets given. And just in the same way you didn't initially believe the darkness, don't initially believe the traveler either.
Yeah.
I think we can say that quite fairly.
You know? I am ready to disprove everything the traveler ever says.
So I got one last question as well.
Sure.
Like, in the new grimoire, the physical one, the grimoire anthology.
Okay.
There's actually a point at which is a quote from Yolande Tan, which talks about how there's like always a symmetry to the universe. And it talks about the deep in the sky, light and shadow, guardians and guardians. Right. Mm. Which is really, really cool for the implication that, hey, maybe guardians can become, paragons of the darkness. If you were given a choice, and I want to know this as well, I want to pose this question to everybody else. It's kind of one really big one. If you were given a choice between light and darkness, which would you end up choosing?
Ugh.
Right. Like fundamentally, which do you end up siding with?
Yeah.
Oof. Because it feels like that might well be a choice that we have to make in the future.
Everyone's like darkness. Yeah. At this
Timmy
moment,
gets a faction. Hell yeah, dude.
Yeah. What if they bring back faction wars and?
No, I was saying Timmy gets a, as in Tim as in darkness 14.
Oh. That was really good. No, you got it. You nailed it. Oh snap. Yeah, dude, Tim will be in charge of that faction. It'll be great. He'll make sure that you work out every day at 5 a.m. You sure you want to join the darkness chat? Mm-hmm. Tim will make you mad. Damn. You want to wake up? You want to wake up with Tim at 5? You know, work out?
Whoop.
I stand Tim. Okay? All right, chat. That's great. I'm glad you feel that way.
To all the Tim stands in the chat, I love the man as well, but
you don't go siding with evil.
I'm siding with the light. Yeah. No question. I'm on both. That's my own personal biases, which I may need to examine anyway. After all, if I'm supposed to not believe the traveler in the same way I'm not believing the darkness, I'm just trying to find discerned truth from everything.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Gotta remember the biases that I have in place. Wait, man. Is there anything else that we should discuss? Because we have been going for like three hours.
Oh, yeah, we covered a lot of ground. I actually have to head out soon to go work out, and then we're opening up the offices tonight for the first time for the jam. Ooh, so that's gonna be fun,
nice, dude.
Yeah, so I got a busy day ahead. So I gotta sign out as well. All I have to say is
thank you for the awesome discussion.
Thank you for the invitation, man. Like, it's always nice to be on the stream.
Yeah, and we, as we say to each other, we should do this more often. And everyone in chat's like, yes!
Let's do it.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Let's see what happens this Season of Dawn. Maybe we can discuss things that may no longer be spoilers. I don't know.
Yeah, seasonal discussion. Yeah, I mean, I'm sure in 6 more weeks, we're probably going to learn a whole bunch more stuff. Weekly? I think weekly's... We'll
talk about it. Maybe in DMs, and we'll see what happens. But like, weekly sounds like it's quite a lot.
Too frequently, yeah. Yeah.
Also, I'm throwing this up on YouTube, so I mean, you know, we'll end up seeing what happens because you know, people love to watch the VODs of all this stuff. But I feel like weekly, getting 3 hours or whatever out to people would be a bit much.
I don't want to have a headache every week from thinking this hard about stuff. Hourly. Time's a construct. Just do it all the time. Everything that's happening is always happening.
Somewhere they are always stepping through.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Bife, thank you so much. I appreciate you. I'm going to wrap things up over here, and I look forward to your next video. Chat, if you're not already following Bife on YouTube and everywhere, just Google or search engine. My name is Bife. And follow that man all over the place.
Likewise, for those of you who are on my YouTube channel who are watching this right now, go ahead and subscribe to the lovely Professor Broman, or alternatively follow him on Twitch. subscriptions cost money. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Follows don't. So go follow him over on Twitch. That'll be twitch.tv/Professor Broman. Yeah, you can go ahead and find him there for all sorts of fun times and Destiny stuff. Also, if you're a fan of watching Twitch reveals for Destiny on day one, watch his stream, because let me tell you, there is only one stream where I googled the YouTube VOD for it afterwards, and that was Ben's reaction to going inside the pyramid ships, and also Ben's reaction to seeing the pyramid ships.
Oh my, everyone was because very excited.
I didn't see it on day one, but I knew I had to see this. Like, there was no way I was missing this. So
thank
yeah.
Thank you. So nice. Thank you, Bife.
Thank you.
Yeah, you have an incredible evening, and we'll talk again soon, man.
All right. And for those of you watching the YouTube video, thank you so much for watching. Do all the typical stuff. I won't leave you with a long outro, but as usual, my name has been Bife. Prodasiad Astra. I will see you, Starside.